Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Andy Brusevich, Councilor, City of Sarnia, and OGRA Director. I trust you enjoyed your lunch and took some time to visit our exhibitors. Ontario's mid-sized cities are in the midst of an economic, social, and environmental golden age. All across Ontario, regions have begun building localized economies that are competing globally. These communities are at a critical time in their development. These fast-growing regions are now facing the challenge of managing growth while also enhancing the quality of life of constituents. This afternoon, we welcome a fantastic, exciting panel to discuss this issue. We have Joe Flatt and Julia Grady, who are the people that will be helping shape how we understand this region. They'll be joined by Thomas Barakat, OGRA Policy Advisor, who will moderate the discussion. Thank you.
Thanks.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to the first session of the afternoon. As you're probably aware, there was supposed to be a third panelist up here, Mike Moffitt, but he's recently taken a new role with the federal government as the chief innovation fellow, and he's can't really comment on a lot of things publicly, so he has had to pull out of this panel. So it's going to be just the two. Over here. So we have Joe Flatt from Evergreen and Julia Grady from Camden.
Tenkarden, sorry.
Messed that one up. And so what we're going to do is they're going to start off with a presentation each, very short, very brief. And then I'm going to moderate a little bit of a discussion. And then we're going to open up to the audience for some questions. And that'll be about an hour long. So, Joe, would you like to get started?
Sure. Okay. Come over. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Joe Flatt. I work at Evergreen. Evergreen is a national charitable organization. We work in cities, in countries, communities across this country. We're based in the Don Valley Brickworks, so if you haven't been to the Evergreen Brickworks, you should definitely check it out. Our mandate is to create flourishing cities, and so we develop programs across the country related to issues of green procurement, housing, transportation, economic development, civic engagement, and now we run a mid-sized cities program, which I'll tell you more about in a minute. But first off, I want to define what I mean when I say a mid-sized city. So this is something that I'm commonly asked. What does that mean in the Canadian context? So here in Ontario, that is focused between 50 and 500,000 residents. And then we subdivide mid-sized cities by function. So we look at three different kinds of mid-sized cities. Center cities, which have historic downtowns, autonomous economies. Their impact as a hub serves sort of the broader region. And then there's satellite or suburban cities, where many of the people leave the communities to find employment. And then rural municipalities, which have a lower population density. So all of these types of cities fall within this sort of population parameter. So what is the Mid-Sized Cities Program? Broadly, it is an initiative being run by Evergreen to better define and develop the strategies that support the unique needs, challenges, and opportunities facing Ontario's mid-sized cities. Can you guys still hear me? It's kind of cutting out. Okay. So who here represents a mid-sized city or is working in a mid-sized city? A few hands. Okay. So we are looking at those specific opportunities and challenges in these types of cities. Oh, thank you. And so to start this work in terms of developing this program, we started off by talking to people. We started with speaking with mayors and councillors and executive directors and activists and developers in mid-sized cities across Ontario to understand what those biggest challenges and opportunities were. What's keeping them up at night? What does the future look like? And so these are just some of the challenges and opportunities that we heard about. And of course, they may be familiar to you, challenges associated with economic development, aging populations, how to retain and attract youth. But then on the opportunity side, really there is a lot going for these cities as well. An abundance of underutilized assets that can be transformed, they're affordable. In some instances, they are seeing new political leadership and this appetite for civic participation. We often heard that there's this small town feel with the amenities of a big city life, which really makes mid-sized cities great places. Part of that research, we also put forward 12 opportunities for action, 12 recommendations of things that we thought mid-sized cities could be doing or actioning on in order to increase their broader social, economic, and environmental vibrancy. And so those are listed here, and I'll sort of speak to some of them, but the idea of creating policy frameworks to build and preserve local assets, building on sort of these key strengths that they already have, investing in strategies to support regional economies, leveraging the role of anchor institutions, investing in human capital and strategies to integrate youth, indigenous communities, and newcomers into the economy, building support for intensification, continuing to encourage civic participation, and you know, learning across mid-sized cities and sharing and best practices across all of those, across all of those cities. So when we looking at those challenges and those opportunities, and we pulled together a program that had two key streams of work. So one was around research and thought leadership. And this was based on one of our initial findings, which was there was really a gap in literature that's focused on the mid-sized cities context. Often when we talk about city building, we're focusing on the big cities, the New Yorks, the Tokyos, the Londons, but we're not necessarily talking about the mid-sized cities. So how can we sort of fill that research gap? Piloting and program development. In this stream, we're actually trying to enact some of the things that we were talking about. So of these recommendations or of these challenges, how do we do things to address them? So I'll elaborate a little bit more. So in the research and thought leadership stream, we created a mid-sized cities research collaborative. We know that there are experts all across Ontario already who are focusing on critical mid-sized cities related issues. They're addressing things like economic development, social infrastructure and housing, the environment, and we've pulled together a network of about 22 and ever increasing growing in numbers to continue to work on this pieces of research, and we'll be sharing sort of a broader compendium of this research in early May with the ambition of really trying to fill that gap and have more conversations and a broader discourse. We'll also be having a mid-sized cities focus conference, so at the end of May, and I'll speak a bit more around that, again, to sort of broaden and further this discourse and this conversation. On the piloting and program development side, we are doing things in four different cities in Ontario. So Hamilton was our flagship city. We were really fortunate that the City of Hamilton, the Community Foundation, the Young Foundation were interested in working with us to pilot and try out some really interesting things. And so as Evergreen, we're fundamentally focused on how do we engage community and decision makers and influencers. And so we were talking with different residents and leadership to understand where was there some real big challenges? Where did things need to be addressed? And so some of you may be familiar with the West Harbor neighborhood in Hamilton. It's undergoing a significant amount of change. And what we heard from the community was, you know, we're a little nervous about what's going to happen here. Like, we're not going to be included, or are we going to be included? And at the same time, the city was saying, yeah, we're doing a lot of things here. How do we make sure the community is engaged and aware of the steps that we're taking? And so we played this brokering role, and we actually created a physical storefront, 294 James Street North. If you're in Hamilton, you should definitely check it out. And essentially, that is a place that's now become a co-working space, a meeting space. It's where the city shares all of its different programs and development intentions. And it's really become this important beacon of community vibrancy. We've seen over 20,000 people through the doors of this storefront since opening in August 2015. So a really interesting model that we'd like to continue to scale and grow. In Peterborough, we created leadership teams in each of these cities. So they tend to represent the chamber, the city, the community foundation, trying to take a multi-sectoral approach to looking at how to address and build on city building initiatives. And so in Peterborough, through consultation, we learned that there was a significant amount of strengths and resources in the area of the green economy. How could we bolster those resources and those assets to build sort of a regional economic development strategy for Peterborough that leverages those areas of momentum and things they already have underway? So now we've been doing some interviews with a whole bunch of different individuals to pull together a bit of a strategic piece, and we'll be having some workshops to look at what are the strategies and the things that we need to be doing, looking at provincial policy, also local opportunities to move that agenda forward. In Greater Sudbury, what we learned was that Sudbury has, as many mid-sized cities do, a number of anchor institutions. Anchor institutions are non-for-profit or public institutions that fundamentally can't get going when the times get tough. They are rooted in place, they have huge real estate assets, huge procurement spends, huge labor forces, and are really big influencers and drivers in the community. So how can they work together to actually advance a broader social, environmental, and economic ambition for the city? And so we hosted the first of its kind conversation, bringing these anchors together to think not just tactically, but strategically about how they can work together to improve the future of their city. In London, we're working on the official plan and its implementation. So some of you may be familiar with the London plan. It's a really compelling example of how the official planning process can be a beacon and a vision for not just a city, but for a municipality, but for a broader community. When we started working in London, we were told, talk to the city, they know what's up. They just did this huge consultation and they did this great official plan and we want to help move it forward. I had never heard that before, which was really, really true testament to the capacity and the capability of a good planning process. And so now we're looking at how the community broadly, so residents, businesses, organizations, institutions, can support its implementation. Because also in today's times, it's really hard for the municipality to implement all of the vision of the official plan single-handedly. So how can you get a broader momentum around that vision? So, learning so far, what have we learned from this work? We've been incubating these projects and there's been a lot of momentum, a lot of interest, a lot of learning. We continue to see that really mid-sized cities are underrepresented in the city building discourse, as I mentioned. And part of that has to do with, while there are many examples of success, the stories aren't always being told in a way that really broadcasts to a large group of individuals. So how can we amplify those voices? How can we get those stories out there? We also learned that there's sort of a perceived disconnect between mid-sized cities and the provincial government. This is something that we're actually really exploring, and mid-sized cities have been telling us, you know, we don't think that we are getting the amount of funding that we necessarily deserve, or we're being recognized to the extent that we should or could be. And on the provincial side, they recognize that they don't necessarily know what it is that mid-sized cities need. So how can, again, we sort of broker those relationships and strengthen those ties? And ultimately, we keep hearing from our practitioners on the ground that they are looking for more tools and strategies and solutions to leverage local assets and to address the challenges they're facing in their city building efforts. So what's next? Where are we headed? At the end of May, May 23rd and 24th, we are co-hosting a conference with CityAge and McMaster, all focused around mid-sized cities in North America. So we'll have American representation there, but really looking at this lens specifically. We'll be having a forum at the end of May as well, which is just bringing our program participants together. And we're looking at strategies to scale the program and build more communities of practice. So is that a physical center that might exist somewhere? Is that further research or resources? What might that look like to continue to embed this in not only in the cities we're working with, but in other cities on top of that? Okay, so that sums up the Mid-Sized Cities program. Thank you. Do you want to take this?
Thanks, I'll take this in case.
Yeah.
Can everyone hear me on this one? Okay, great. I'm Julia Grady. I'm from Guelph, Ontario, great mid-sized city. I'm the co-founder of an organization called 10 Carden, and our tagline is creating space for change. We're a not-for-profit community event and social innovation hub, basically, in downtown Guelph. This is a picture of Guelph in about that's turn of the century, which is fun. We describe ourselves as a living lab for social change. We bring together community, so tons and tons of individuals, and act as a gathering space and an incubator for research and organizations who are all under the umbrella of social change. We founded in 2009, so we're this is our eighth year. We run a 3,000 square foot space in downtown Guelph. We have about 100 members of organizations, individuals, and students. We're 80% self-funded by our own services, and we've got a ton of great collaborations and track records on past projects. Those could be Trillium granted projects or community-based projects working with the city or the university. We have a couple of active community research projects, and those are around small-scale rooftop agriculture, community bonds, and the impacts that those could have on facility builders in cities, and then the role of co-working facilities in Ontario's mid-sized cities as they grow and change. I wanted to highlight a little bit about this. So a co-working center is, if everyone's not familiar, it's basically a shared space where people are coming together to work on their own enterprises, but the bigger picture piece is that they're then also collaborating and making more out of the work they're doing. And we did some research for the Ministry of Municipal Affairs and Housing in 2016 around this. So across in 2016, across Ontario, there are 40 plus co-working centers. Over half of them were in mid-sized cities, so it's not all in the larger cities. And 79% are also in the regions designated as the urban growth centers. There's a split between not-for-profit and for-profit, and I obviously represent a not-for-profit, but there's a huge growth, obviously, for for-profit co-working. And a lot of them they're all space-based and are needing to grow into bigger spaces and working on expansion. And only 23% describe their financial outlook as strong, which shows that this is hard work for co-working centers. They're all nearly located, though, in downtowns of mid-size of the cities, which Tencarden is as well. A lot of these centers cross disciplines, so some are just purely tech hubs, but most are actually spanning all the disciplines, which at the end of the day helps organizations work better together. So there's some interesting data from the 14 that we reported on. A little bit of narrative around what these spaces are about. It's totally different than commercial real estate, and there are supportive spaces that can allow anyone to come together to work on a project or an idea. Even if they're not dealing specifically with employment, the model helps people gain more visibility and connections, which can more naturally lead to employment. They can be the heartbeat of the business ecosystem in a city, and especially in small towns or cities that need relationships and awareness to launch things. There's magic that happens between individuals from these centers. We did and part of the survey was how do these centers partner with larger organizations? So Joe spoke to some of the anchor organizations that are obviously important in cities. Co-working is really about 8 years old in Ontario, 8 to 12 years old, basically. So a lot of these organizations are not anchor institutions, and they're the kind of underdogs that are working with others. You can see that there's pretty good, though, connections between organizations on the non-financial side. So people are partnering well, and institutions are open to partnerships with these new organizations. And then when you kind of overlay a financial side, you really see a difference. So there's a lot of connection, but then there's not a lot of direct either money flowing in or back and forth between. So that's there's a gap there and or opportunity for municipalities to look at what's happening in the co-working side and how that can affect their economic development policy or also their social sustainability. Things that co-working centers are working on are improving their space, becoming bigger, and then working to increase their membership. All of them are working on collaboration, so the organizations that are aligning underneath co-working centers are naturally collaborative, and for municipalities could be potentially great collaborators on the community engagement side. And my opinion is that we're all contributing to the vitality of our cities and shaping things. And so we did that research. At the same time, Tencarden itself was undergoing massive transformation. We were in an underutilized space in downtown Guelph, but below market rents, 3,000 square feet over three floors, totally inaccessible. But we had a beautiful building with a lot of potential. And we basically nurtured our community there. We support a ton of sectors and organizations, and after two or three years in, we knew we needed to change. So this is a couple of pictures of what our space is like. It's about performance, it's about co-working, it's about convening, and the big piece is about community dialogue. And there's a lot that municipalities obviously do on that front, but there's also a lot of opportunity for citizens to get involved. And in Guelph, our experience is that there's a huge demand for citizens to be involved in that. So sometimes shared space or co-working seems just like office, and it's really not. We definitely need to expand what the thoughts are on it. Championing ideas, catalyzing community, and working for change. The work is fun, challenging, and largely underfunded. And I'm going to tell you a bit about what we're doing right now. So, the little space on this side is where we are now. We've basically purchased this 15,000 square feet building that spans two blocks in downtown Guelph, and it's on Carden Street, which is our right across from City Hall, and the community put in a splash pad and skating rink a few years ago. And it's the shiniest street in our city. We've got the Basilica in the background, and this is the center for our downtown. We knew that if we were going to stay and be relevant to the community and build longer-term partnerships, we needed to change everything. So we went ahead and forged a crazy plan to purchase and redevelop a building. It's the Acres Furniture Building, which has never been on the market. So it had been that building for 100 years with no opportunity for just activation. So we're working on this $4 million project that keeps me up at night. The building, though, was a four-story furniture building that had two employees, and maybe five or six people would walk through there in a day. So by day one, our project will bring 50 FTEs into that space, co-aligned under all of the projects they're working on, and then hundreds more a week in terms of community events and all the conversations and activities that happen at 10 Carden. So right away, we have a vibrant, active space that will attract more people to the downtown in terms of work and commercial. The top floor, we've got an amazing partnership with the University of Guelph, and we're piloting a three-year pilot to launch a community classroom. The university is a couple of kilometers away up the hill, and they don't have an official long-term downtown presence yet, although that's in the germination and the plans for downtown. This will give them a way to test it out and see if the institution's open to it and see how they could actually operate a downtown campus. So we're very excited about that. It also helps us integrate research and students into some of the work that 10 Carden's doing. We carved up a lot of the space. On the second floor, there's office space and open concept co-working, but 50% of the building is dedicated to community use. And our mission is, we're not-for-profit, so we don't need to make a ton of money other than servicing all this debt, obviously. But what we do commit to is accessible space for community and then also affordable at the scale that groups and especially grassroots can afford. We're funding it by a ton of implements, including our first mortgage, donations and service in kind, capital grants and sponsorships. And so far we've raised $475,000 in grants and sponsorships, and we're actively working to continue that piece. One of our single biggest grants in this stream was from the City of Guelph through their downtown activation program. So within Guelph CIP, they have granted funds that can be applied to projects that stimulate these underutilized buildings. So we were the recipient of that in last year. This is a wacky picture of our basement. And that grant really, our employment numbers changed, made that possible, and also the use of the space. One of the most exciting pieces around the project is our community bond financing program, and the community needs and wants 10 Carden, but it's a not-for-profit that operates on a grassroots budget that's sometimes laughable. So for it to sustain and be great and creative and interesting in our city, we needed to have support from the community. So what we've worked with the community bond model that the Center for Social Innovation has used on their projects and set up a second mortgage that lets community come in and assume some of that risk with us. So to date, we've got a whole series of bonds. To date, we've raised over $800,000 in community bond investments from 70 community investors. And those folks range from people coming in at just $1,000, it could be they're 20-something with their very first investment, to someone who's retired with a $125,000 investment. So we're very proud of it. And the one thing that has kept us going in this process is that the community is willing to take some of the risk to build these projects. This project had that 110 grand from the municipality, but at the end of the day, it's largely built by the citizens and the projects that are within Tencarden, which is an interesting way for municipalities that are strapped with their own financing and capital projects to assist in a small way projects going forward. So to that note, we're wildly passionate about the community bonds piece, and in this era of everything, people are looking for local investments, they're looking for ways to change their communities. And we have a pilot grant that will let us work for the year in other cities across Ontario. So if anyone's interested in having us come to speak about how we've done this in Guelph and how it could affect another community of any size or scale, the project is, there's a magic that needs to happen, which is the collaborations amongst organizations, but it is possible for not-for-profits that do have a funding stream and revenue sources to turn some of these cool buildings in your downtowns into other community hubs. So I'm really excited about that piece, and I think I'm done. This is our project mantra, which was, it always seems impossible until it's done. We're done in June, so we should be open June 1st-ish, and I will be happy to report back. Thanks.
Thank you, Julia. That was great. So as you all know, we're here for this is about regional economies and building up regional economies. And our two presenters here have done a pretty good job in kind of framing this in a sort of community building way. And obviously the projects that you guys have been working on are a reflection of that. So I kind of want to pick your brain a little bit about a few things. First one would be education. So kind of what role does higher education play in these kind of local economic development, community building type projects in these communities?
So I think the anchor institutions or these post-secondary institutions are really, really significant in the mid-sized cities context. What we've seen from our work in Peterborough and London and Sudbury and Hamilton is that they are significant drivers, and they really open the door. They bring a lot of the youth into the community, and it's about strategically thinking about how to leverage all of those youth that come for those years of their learning and in order to stay. So that's one sort of driving element. Also, in the case of Peterborough, the university is actually leading a research park that's going to be focused around sort of green tech and green opportunities. It's doing this in collaboration with the city, but it's really that driving force to position the city and therefore the region in a unique way is actually coming from the university itself. And then the programming and education they offer to their students enable them to work in that research park. So you're seeing a sort of a deeper integration on a few different economic scales that's in a big way coming from the university.
Okay.
Yeah, and I can echo that in Guelph as well. The university came in to our organization probably the second year as a strong partner. So universities of any of them in the they're willing to be partners with things that are in germination stages, which is great. And we have a research piece that's a community engaged scholarship institute basically is physically forming at Tencarden, so they will be there permanently, which will give a great help organizations add like an academic lens to all of their work, but also give students these great opportunities for research and community-based engagement that they don't have unless they're in the community. So one of our dream, I think, pieces is that as Guelph becomes employment grows and especially on the small business and entrepreneurship side, there's actually a way to keep those students who've done a lot of great research and keep them in the community for the long term.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and this is actually a good segue into the next theme, I guess, I'd like to discuss, which is innovation and this kind of startup kind of culture. And this is probably a little bit more directed towards you, Julia, as you have the shared space. So how do you foster this type of environment in a place like Guelph or in a mid-sized city versus a place like Toronto where a lot of people are drawn there. There's ecosystems already existing. Maybe Waterloo might be an example of something as well. But how do you kind of, it seems like you've kind of done it and you're kind of starting to bring it all together there. So anything else you want to add, I guess?
Yeah, I think we're on the road towards that. Guelph exists, Tenkarn exists in kind of the ecosystem of innovation Guelph, so they're more focused on the commercialization of and scale up of MITS SMEs to large projects. And there's a lot of it is around relationship building and creating those forums for people to hear about different projects. We're not necessarily a business incubator, but we're definitely a supporter of projects and especially social change things that are happening. And those, I think, need partnerships and collaboration. So our center just naturally helps that occur, which does become very important for projects, and especially when they're not fully formed yet. They can access mentorship really easily. They can make the appropriate connects versus not knowing who to talk to and whatnot. And Guelph is highly entrepreneurial. I think we're about 50% entrepreneurs right now, which these kinds of centers become really important in that environment, because I've always said that if you want to have a job in Guelph, you really need to make your own, and that that can only happen in community. So I think that's mostly where our role is.
Okay.
Yeah, what's also interesting is that in a lot of mid-sized cities, like thinking about Sudbury, for example, they had historic industries that are now in need of change or development and growth. And it's very interesting to see how these cities do come together to think about what innovation means in the context, so in Sudbury, about mining, and how they can think about consulting services or offshoot services, leveraging that huge resource base and that expertise that they have, and then promoting that to global and new and different audiences. But it's definitely a challenge for them to say, okay, we have this asset base, we have these skills, we have this talent, but we need to shift. What does that look like, and how can we do that? And what we started to see is a lot of that has come through new kinds of partnerships and new kinds of collaborations. Again, like these incubators that a bunch of different sectors are co-funding to have in the downtown, and thinking about new markets outside of their city that they can then take that skill set to. And in their case, they're actually trying to be environmental leaders around the mining industry. And so that's a different take on how they can take that skill set they already have into a broader way.
Okay. So the third kind of theme that I'd like to kind of touch on it is something that's near and dear to my heart as a millennial, is diversity. And places like Toronto or Montreal or Vancouver, the big cities, obviously a lot of people come in there, and there's communities, and they kind of it helps economic development. There's different thoughts, different ideas. There seems to be a little bit of a difference in the experience in mid-sized cities. What can mid-sized cities do, I guess, to kind of not only attract diversity, I guess, or newcomers, but how can they convert that to economic development in a way? Mm-hmm. Is that something that, you know, maybe through your experiences you guys could, you know, touch on?
Yeah, I'll start on that. I think Guelph has obviously kind of grown and changed over time, and we're becoming more diverse, but I don't think we'd be called a hugely diverse city. But the biggest thing I think that is inclusion, is just having a space that it feels comfortable for anyone to come into, no matter what their space is, right? And Tenkarn does this really well. It's funny because we just had some hosts who are volunteers with Tenkarn wondering about, in our transformation to the new shiny accessible building, will we still be as community-based and accessible to everyone? And we basically came up with a tagline that they wanted to put on the door, which was no pretending and everyone's welcome. So the I think it's a lot of it's kind of, that's a lot of like vision, but it's mostly around really openly wanting there to be integration and to have the same opportunities for everyone. So I think that's where we are, and the human relationships actually can help with everything else. And I think that's where Tenkarn is at, and a lot of other organizations then would be working in terms of like employment and actually providing services, so that like Guelph has a ton of new Syrian refugees, obviously, and the language skills is still very slow to develop because there aren't the systems in place yet that are helping us along. So
just to echo that, I think there's a deliberate recognition that needs to be articulated about these mid-sized cities wanting to focus on diversity and wanting to move forward on building newcomer supports or indigenous supports or whatever it is. So I had mentioned that there was an anchor meeting in the fall in Sudbury where we had a bunch of anchors come around the table together to say, how can we strategically collaborate? And in that room, someone said, we have a problem here. We need to address issues of systemic racism so that when we bring in 1,500 international students, they can get jobs, and people want to employ them, and they're not scared of foreigners or people that they're not familiar with. So I think there really is a deliberate effort that has to be made, and it needs to be across sectors, and it needs to be integrated into a bunch of different ways and processes and building that social capital. Because the irony is that we hear from these from our members like that there's such a close-knit network in these cities, and it's so beautiful, the relationships and the connectivity. So how do you make sure that everyone is a part of that? And so that's a really important thing that needs to be done in a deliberate fashion.
Okay. So we are talking about regional economies here. So why don't we talk a little bit about the relationship between, for example, the mid-sized cities, you know, the Londons, the Hamiltons, the Kitchener-Waterloos, the Guelphs, and their surrounding communities. If you know, these are the centers, I guess, of employment and the services and education. So what kind of relationship do they have, or should they have, with the surrounding communities, and how can it be, I guess, fostered to be better and to generate more, I guess, economic development or partnerships or anything, really?
Yeah, so I think every city and every region is going to be different. I think it's always challenging. The more you collaborate can be more interest to manage, so it's not an easy effort to move ahead on in terms of wanting to have more regional collaboration, but it can really demonstrate significant success and have a big impact. So one example that I've seen, which is really fascinating in Peterborough, is they created Sustainable Peterborough. And what this is a group of the city and the county and the First Nations groups all in the region coming together to create a plan around how they're going to integrate sustainability into their actions in these various municipalities. And what that does is it lets them have a common voice, a shared voice, more power, and then they can again strategically align and support each other as they move ahead. So I think it can be challenging, but it can have significant payoff if you put forward the alignment and the strategic work needed.
Yeah, and I echo that basically. I think it all comes back to the alignment and who's involved and how and what's practical for different organizations. The main thing I can speak to is the co-working centers and collaborative centers across Ontario are open to being collaborative but without the resources to spend a lot of time in that, because they're all really focused on their own operations. So then you really have to look at, well, do you have something that you can share and make it as easy as possible for other groups to share?
Mm-hmm. Okay. So another thing that I wanted to talk about is sort of a kind of let's say, could be quality of life, or you know, when you compare that with mid-sized cities to bigger cities. And in a way, when you're trying to compete with these bigger cities to attract people to come and work and go to school and whatnot, what advantages or opportunities do mid-sized cities have over bigger cities? And also, what kind of disadvantages are there as well? First thing that comes to my mind would be something like housing, for example. In Toronto, you know, you might be able to get a condo for a certain amount of money, but if you go to a smaller city or a mid-sized city, you might be able to get more. So something along these, is there anything, you know, that you guys could add to that?
Mm-hmm. Sure.
Yeah?
I live in a mid-sized city, so Guelph is 120 to 125 or so thousand people. Employment is I think, a key issue. And especially with our mix of, we've got a pretty strong manufacturing base still, but there's you really have to build your own job, and that I think has challenges for tons of people. Our quality of life is awesome. It's a beautiful city. It's near Toronto. We're surrounded by food. It's like sometimes a bit of a utopia, but there's you know, safety, volunteerism, and it's easy to access in terms of relationships and organizations and people. Like the landscape and the world is so small in that more, it's a little bit more closely knit, so it is a little bit easier to maneuver than probably Hamilton or certainly Toronto. And I think there's lots of housing, but we're feeling a lot of pressure from Toronto now moving out, right? Especially with the GO train, which is awesome that we can work back and forth between. But it does put pressures on those mid-sized cities where their economies haven't grown yet to sustain the higher levels of housing, and we're competing with Toronto.
Yeah, I think it's really important that when we think about Ontario and an Ontario that serves all of the different residents who want to live here, mid-sized cities are a critical component of that. You cannot have everyone living in Toronto or even the GTA. It doesn't match the lifestyles or the demands or the needs of the broader group. So when I think about mid-sized cities, they're this critical part of our urban fabric as a province and as a country. And so how can we continue to enable and build on those assets? You know, the closeness to nature that you often have in mid-sized cities, the affordability of the housing. How do you preserve these assets and make sure that you continue to invest in them and develop them and think about the whole package of creating an Ontario that we are proud of?
Okay. So we have about 10 or so minutes left now, which is kind of what I wanted to leave allocated to questions from the audience. There are some mics set up there. Is there anybody that wants to ask a question for the panel? If you do, please go to the mic. No? Okay, well, there's actually a couple more things I'd like to ask. One is something that you touched on, Julia, just now, which is the connectivity to communities like Guelph. So the provincial government has, with the big move, has been really trying to improve this type of transportation corridors, I guess. Does it run the risk, though, of turning some of these communities more into sort of like a bedroom community versus actually fostering local economic development to have self-sustaining kind of employment within the city center? And would, you know, these funds, would they be better used to build LRTs or something within the city itself rather than just connecting everything to Toronto? It's kind of a curveball throwing at you guys.
Let's take an answer from the audience for that one. I'm not a transportation expert.
Okay.
So yeah. I think Guelph having greater access to the GO is
a positive.
Awesome.
Okay.
It's a total positive. Yeah. It's, I think, what people need to, I think when mid-sized cities have more access than to transportation, they still need to be working really tirelessly on their own economic development strategies so that you're making sure that you're, that there are opportunities in the city versus out. And at one point, I think we were a net exporter of, importer of people, which was great. And I'd be curious to see data on, in like the next 5 years, does that change because of the GO? I know with Waterloo and the talk of the innovation highway or innovation corridor, Guelph has been thinking about, well, what's our framing on that? Because we're a stop on the corridor, so the university has a food strategy in terms of innovation and how to place that. And well, it'll be interesting to see if that does come to more employment and research in the food sector on the ground.
Yeah, I do think connectivity is really important, both within a region or within a city, and of course, and to, you know, mega cities like Toronto. I think that could be very beneficial. But to your point, what is it that's the local economic development strategy for that region, for that city, and how do you harness and focus on building that out so you don't just become a bedroom community? I mean, it'd be interesting. I was something that I would actually consider wanting to look into. What are the makings of that? You know, what contributes to that versus the other options, and how can we ensure that that doesn't necessarily take place? Part and parcel with thinking about connectivity.
Okay. So we still have a little bit of time left. I'll kind of go back to this sort of quality of life type thing that we had talked about earlier, and this is something that I'm not sure if you'll be able to answer, but one thing that some of the bigger cities have, or maybe over sort of the mid-sized cities, is cultural centers. They seem there's more money to spend on art galleries or museums or anything, but in smaller or mid-sized communities, there still are, you know, cultural events or arts-related events. Is there something along those lines that you guys have kind of come across that maybe you could see as an advantage between mid-sized cities and bigger cities, or is that just a big advantage for the bigger cities?
I think, so I'm from Guelph, and Guelph has a really vibrant arts and culture scene. We have Hillside, the Jazz Festival, tons of things. I think there's a question of scale, right? So smaller cities can still have all those activities, but they're on a different scale. And one of our kind of missions was to create a little bit more physical infrastructure for those smaller scale things to happen. We've got like a improv scene and a comedy scene and tons of music happening, but they sometimes stay grassroots, but they don't quite grow. So I think cities should be thinking about when they have a lot of arts and culture kind of inventory, how to put in place strategies that can be a little bit more supportive, because they're all funding is the key piece, right? There are audiences in place, but without funding, it's really challenging to grow that and.
Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah.
Yeah, I think arts and culture is a huge asset for any city, for any community. You know, you have in Hamilton, I think it's Art is the New Steel, so it's like really trying to leverage this culture, this interest, and I think it will happen in any place, whether it's large or small. You have artists, you have people who want to experience urban expression and civic participation through various art forms, and that really contributes to, especially in my opinion, as a holistic part of building a really great and vibrant city. And so I think that all municipalities should be pursuing their own variations on arts and culture. I do think there's opportunities to take maybe what's in Toronto and have offshoots. Right, so if we were to think about the ROM and having a northern campus of the ROM as a hub for areas within the north, I think there's interesting ideas that we can play on there. But then Peterborough also has the Canoe Museum, this really sort of unique cultural asset that I think mm-hmm. anyone from across Ontario would be interested in pursuing. So I think, again, it's like leveraging on the strengths and the innate sort of culture and arts that are in those communities to build vibrancy.
Right, okay. Well, thank you very much for those answers. And our time is up now, so I would just like to thank our two panelists here for their wonderful presentations and answers to my questions here. So please give a round of applause.
Thanks.
Thank you, Joe Flatt and Julia Grady, for sharing your vision and perspectives. I found it interesting, useful. And you lived up to the expectation of being dynamic duo that you are, and I'm looking forward in the future to hear more from you when we have a little bit more time, because you could probably give us way, way more than you're able within the time we had. So thank you both, ladies, and I'm looking forward to hear and see you again. Our next shift disturber is Rahul Singh, the man right here. Rahul spoke at our conference once before, and he's the founder and executive director of Global Medic. He is here today to talk about how a Made in Ontario approach to saving lives is being implemented on the other side of the world. Please welcome back to OGRA stage, Rahul Singh.
Thanks so much. Well, thanks. How's the mic? Here. All right. Thank you so much for having me. And I guess this is going to block some of the room here. But we'll get started. So this conference is about reinvigorating you to have a discussion about emergent issues that not only face us in the province, but that face us globally. And I'm going to use my 15 minutes. They're going to put up a little timer here for me so I don't babble on forever. I'm going to use my 15 minutes to pitch you a new idea. And that idea is going to be the Ontario Innovation Relief Fund. Of course, it's going to be a global medic initiative, okay? Now, the pitch or the principle is to recognize that there are major large-scale catastrophes that occur around the world. And people die because of these disasters, but what's worse is the people that survive the initial acute event, be it an earthquake, be it the flood, be it the war, they're vulnerable. And they will die if we don't deliver them aid in the first 72 to 96 hours after that. And I'll be very frank with you, we as the world fall down in delivering people assistance immediately. We're really good at talking about it. We're really good at saying, wow, that's terrible. But we're really bad globally at getting aid in immediately. So I think before we really get into this discussion, I want you to tell me, in your minds, just what do you think a disaster is? So if we think back in the last decade or so, we all remember the tsunami. We remember that Haitian earthquake. We think about Hurricane Katrina. But do we understand what disaster looks and feels like? So what I want you to do is I want you to watch this video with an understanding of what disaster actually is. What do you think when you see a video like that? Like, what are the first words that pop into your head? Chaos, death, pain, suffering. 1.4 million people affected by a 42-second event in January of 2010. That's the Haiti earthquake. Everybody in that video that you see that's a survivor, what do they need? I mean, it's a pretty simple answer, isn't it? We know they're going to need shelter. We know they're going to need clean drinking water. We know they're going to need food. And we know they need access to healthcare, right? These are some of the basic items that we know people need. What I want to do is I want to make a better way of Ontario to be in the world in terms of delivering aid. Now, I know, being municipal leaders, your first thought's going to be, why is this an Ontario issue? This is a federal issue. Delivering aid internationally is not a provincial or municipal function, right? Wrong. If you look back in the last 12 or so years, this is exactly how much the provincial government has given to large-scale events. It's about $12 million, $12.6 million over the last 12 years. So it roughly averages about $1 million a year. I would put forth the premise and the argument to you that this was a beautiful reactionary event or reactionary decision to give money to people in need, but this money could have been better spent and more effective had we thought about it in advance. And that's what this pitch is all about, okay? So we've identified the problem. The problem is we know disasters occur. And we know what people need immediately after. And we know now that Ontario is a player in this space because we are giving money. So how are we gonna do it better? Well, what Global Medic proposes is the Ontario Innovation Relief Fund. I want an envelope of money every single year. And with that envelope of money, we will buy Ontario-made, innovative, life-saving products that we will deploy on day one of the crisis so that they arrive within the first 48 hours and they start getting into the hands of people in the first 72 and the first 96 hours. That push strategy that is absolutely missing from disaster response. We've seen this. Now, why us, right? Has anyone heard of Global Medic before? Because if you haven't, we are an Ontario innovation. We're homegrown. We are paramedics, police officers, firefighters, doctors, surgeons, nurses, water engineers, and now drone pilots. Professional rescuers who volunteer our time to deploy globally. In the last decade, we've responded to 176 missions in 61 countries. We've touched the lives of 2.8 million people, and you still haven't heard of us. Can you imagine if you funded us? How much more leverage we would get with that reach. So we're an Ontario innovation, we're successful, we receive money from the federal government, from other governments. While I'm talking to you today, we have people in the hot war zone in Ukraine. We have people running aid into Syria and Iraq in very troubled areas. We have people working to rebuild homes in the Philippines. We have people delivering water units in Haiti. Volunteers from right here in Ontario delivering aid and assistance. I think it's important now to talk about the actual innovations. If we know that people need clean drinking water after a crisis, There's two ways that we can get them water: point of source and point of use units, right? So what's a point of source unit? You see these big monster units kind of sitting on the edge of the table here? The idea is we can throw them into a lake or a river and pull that water out and purify it right on the spot and then provide that out, right? So point of source, we went to the source point to provide water to folks, right? So the one unit over here on my left can do 40 liters a minute. Guys, I can get everybody in this room clean water in 3 minutes and 12 seconds, and that's your water for the day if I have that unit up and running. Let's flash back in time to October of 16. On a Tuesday, Hurricane Matthew obliterates the western Tiburon Peninsula of Haiti. On Thursday, our teams are on the ground carrying seven of those units, five of these units, and 1,000 family emergency kits. On the Friday morning, those units are running, which means thousands of people are getting clean water. Put that in perspective. Your five-year-old child isn't gonna die of cholera now. Your 71-year-old grandmother isn't gonna die of typhoid or another waterborne disease because of a $4,000 or $5,000 innovation made in Ontario, delivered by Ontarians, who then go and teach and train local Haitians on the technology, leave the equipment there so the equipment can be run. Point of source. The unit right in front of me, this can produce 12 liters a minute, right? So it'll take me three times as long to fill the room. But the idea is a unit like this can help people in schools, in community centers, in different shelters. A unit like that can help an entire city, right? These are inexpensive Ontario-made solutions. So the other way we can deliver clean water is what's showing on the photo and what's showing right next to me here. This is a point of use unit. So the idea, and it's revolutionary, it's innovative, and we've really brought this forward, is we give this to the family, right? We give it right to the family. There's no moving parts, there's no electricity, it's gravity fed, it's a ceramic filter. This is like age old technology. This is caveman technology, guys. Ceramic filtration. So we teach mom in the family how to put this together, and then mom and the kids start getting the water and pouring it in the top bucket, right? Quite simple. They pour it in the top bucket. You can see the filters here. And then all of a sudden, the water dribbles down into the bottom bucket, and it's clean. And it means mom has now protected her family because the kids have clean water, and they're not going to get sick, right? That unit is about $45. By the time we get it to a family, train them how to use it, it's about $50, $55. And it's going to run for a year. So a family will get clean water for about $7 per person per year. I can't even get water like that in Toronto for that price, right? That's lives saved. And this is made right here in Ontario. And one of the best parts of this is we can engage Ontario volunteers. If you're watching the video, these are volunteers that are drilling the buckets and assembling the units so we can drive the price of these units even further down and engage not necessarily the folks that are out there delivering this aid, but engage every single community, the Boy Scouts, other groups, right? High school kids, you know, folks that just want to give back. We have hundreds of volunteers that come out and produce these units. When this unit was introduced to us, I said, I want to see this in the most austere environments possible. So we put them into Yemen and Somalia, pretty tough spots, right? And they worked. And since then, in the last 5 or 6 years, we've deployed 58,000 units to 14 countries. That's almost 60,000 families, 300,000 folks that have had clean water systems, right? So the point of use system is another unit that works. I want to talk about another type of innovation, and that is blast film technology, right? You can watch the video. The idea is in schools and nursing homes, in war zones where you get indiscriminate fire, the concussive blast, right, the concussive blast of the mortar shell going off will shatter the windows, and look what it does. It turns them into shards and projectiles that will kill everybody inside, right? So here's what we do. We take firefighters, we take medics, we take our rescuers, we go over and we train locals, we hire locals, and we put this ridiculous looking film onto the glass, and look what happens. Window's still gonna break, but the shards don't come in. So if you have a school or a hospital that is in the line or indirect line of fire, and you put this film in, again, Ontario made innovation, Ontario company, right, in Lower Etobicoke that sells this. And you put it into schools, that's who you're protecting. You see those kids? Make no mistake, they could be any one of your kids. They're just unfortunate that they live in a war zone. So here's an innovation that absolutely saves lives. And what is it, $2, $3 a meter per window? And we're going to keep these kids alive? That's a phenomenal innovation. We can build houses in a different way using compressed earth block technology. You see these blocks? These blocks are made by using dirt and a little bit of cement. So rather than buying big bricks that are made from multinational corporations post, you know, hurricane or typhoon in the Philippines, we come in with these machines, we get to hire every single local that's there, start mixing this dirt and cement. Remember, we're hiring everyone, right? So the key, the disruptor here is the money is not going to large corporations, it's going to the people that actually need it. And all of a sudden, we build permanent homes. You know, that's innovation. Building permanent homes cheaper and quicker than what everybody else is delivering on an Ontario-made innovation that gives people jobs and a future. And I mean, look at the photo coming up here. Look at the homes. They are incredible. People want to live in these forever. You know, they are look at the beautiful townhouses. You know, these are probably 1.4 million at Yonge and St. Clair. Another innovation. This is ground-penetrating radar. Remember the Ecuador earthquake a few months back? People are trapped under the rubble. We bring these units in. We're on the rubble pile. Sorry, we'll go back to this one here. We're on the rubble pile, and we're actually trying to find survivors with this technology. Again, Ontario made. I will find your heartbeat and your breathing motion in that rubble pile so I can get rescuers to you and pull you out of that rubble pile to save your life, right? And they're not very big looking, but it's a technical team. Again, Ontario rescuers that come in. And you can see us on the rubble piles in Ecuador. There are people alive under there, and if they have any shot at living, it's going to be because this unit finds them. Put it in perspective, 1,500 buildings down, 7 reasonable dig teams from the world that are there. Everybody is saying, my mother is under that building. How do you triage that down? You can use dogs. We had lists of 911 calls to say where the people said they were trapped, where they were living, right? Bring in ground penetrating radar. I have a survivor target mark here, bring in a dig team, we move on to the next thing. This is the stuff that saves lives, made in Mississauga. Unmanned aerial vehicle programs. You're about to hear about us in a few weeks getting a massive grant. I'm embargoed from talking about it this week. It's a shame the conference didn't happen in a few days. We want to use drone technology to save lives. Every time there's a crisis, we can put these UAVs up. That is a $150,000 UAV. We can put this up, we can take tens of thousands of photos, cross-stitch those photos, make emergency maps to get more information out there to responders, to teams that are trying to deliver aid. I can tell you what roads are closed, I can tell you where populations have moved, I can tell you the extent of damage in certain neighborhoods, all because of this technology. Have you ever heard the phrase, you can't manage something till you can measure it? Do you know how hard it is to manage a crisis zone if you cannot measure what's actually happening? Can you imagine an Ontario-made innovation up the road in Waterloo that's run by Ontario pilots all around the world to bring information to the emergency managers running that response? Makes aid delivery more efficient. These are some of the this is some of the stuff that we can do. All right, folks, this is the pitch and this is what I need from you. You are stewards of the public purse, your elected officials, your thought leaders, your people that are looking for good ideas, and you know good ideas when you see them. I need your help. I need your networks. I need your influence. And I need you to talk to the elected officials in this province and say, you know what? An innovative relief fund is actually a good idea. Because when crisis strikes, if we were deploying on the first day Ontario-made innovations like water units and deploying Ontario UAVs, these unmanned aerial vehicles, to help the local government and figure out exactly what's going on, then we would be helping to save lives. There's a secondary impact here, guys. When we get all this product on the ground and delivered, other aid agencies that are now going to get flush with injects of cash and funding are going to be like, wow, look at that product. It actually works. I'll buy more. So you can have a direct return on investment, which means more Ontario jobs. You know what? Even if we fail to create a single job, I'm happy with saving 2 million lives, and I think you would be as well. So the pitch is, we'll run the grant, we'll find the products, we'll deliver the products and save lives, right? Your role is to talk this up and tell people this is a good idea and let's get it funded. Because we know, right now, we know the caseload is not slowing down, right? There are 65 million refugees and internally displaced people in the world. That's the highest number since World War II. Does anyone think disasters are stopping? Absolutely not. Compound all that with urbanization, the migrant crisis, and climate change, I have a feeling that our industry is going to be a little bit busier in the next few years. Does anyone think that there's going to be more money available to respond to crisis? Absolutely not. So the only way to do more with less, right? The only way to do more with less is to innovate, right? That's the only thing to do. So together, all of us, this is what we can do. Together, we can have Ontarians saving lives, delivering hope, and bringing the best of Ontario out to the world in its time of need. Thank you.
Stay here.
Yeah, has it been brutal?
On behalf of OGRA, I wanted to thank Rahul for coming and speaking to us today. When you listen to what he has to say, you can tell we would consider him as a shift disturber. I was fortunate enough a few years ago to introduce Rahul at this very conference, and when you hear about the number of missions that he's engaged Global Medic in, it is an amazing feat. And when I look at the even simple things as drone technology and how it can be better used to find people when it's really needed, is really nice to see. So, Rao, on behalf of OGRA, thank you for coming today.
Thanks so much.
Okay. We'll just call it. Yeah, we're going to tear that down.
Yeah, no. Is this mic still on? Or? You can tell them we'll have the stuff here. If they want to see it after the event, we'll gladly explain it to folks.
Okay. We good? We're good? Okay. Today, I'm very pleased to welcome back to the OGRA stage the 25th Premier of Ontario, the Honourable Kathleen Wynne. First elected in 2003, Kathleen became the leader of the Ontario Liberal Party in January of 2013. She's also served as Minister of Agriculture and Food, Minister of Municipal Affairs and Housing, Minister of Aboriginal Affairs, Minister of Transportation, and Minister of Education. As the Minister of Municipal Affairs and Housing, she's finalized a new funding agreement with the federal government to improve access to affordable housing. Together with her partner Jane, Premier Wynne has lived in North Toronto for more than 25 years. I'd also like to introduce today Allison Smith, who is the publisher of Queen's Park Today, who will join the Premier as well as other party leaders on stage for a fireside chat. Please join me in welcoming the Honourable Kathleen Wynne and Allison Smith.
First? Yeah. Thanks, Robert. Thank you. Thanks, Allison. Great to see you. So you're going to start with some remarks?
So, good afternoon, everyone. It's great to be here with you. I was just remarking to Scott backstage that I think the OGRA conference. At the time, Roma OGRA was the first event that I attended when I became premier in 2013, and I am very pleased to be here. And I, Allison, thank you for this format. I'm looking forward to our conversation. I just wanted to say to everyone here that it's been a privilege and an honor to work with you. Robert went through all of the ministries that I have worked in, but I think that the work that I did when I was Minister of Transportation, I worked most closely with you, and it was really where I got the sense of how important infrastructure was to the province. I had always known intellectually that infrastructure was an important part of the economic growth and development of the province. But as Minister of Transportation, as I traveled around the province, I got a sense of the backlog of need that that we were confronting in Ontario in terms of our infrastructure. And so now being the having had the opportunity now to sit in this chair for a number of years, we've been making changes to acknowledge the needs of infrastructure in the province. And I know Allison's going to want to talk about a number of those. But whether it's ongoing commitment on highways and you know, including the $2 billion that we've invested in northern highway infrastructure since 2013, or whether it's the new OSIF fund that is building to $300 million and has now got a larger formula base in it than application base because of input that we got from municipalities, or whether it's Connecting Links funding, which when I was Minister of Transportation, we would always be scrambling at the end of the fiscal year to see if there was a way of putting some money into Connecting Links. Now we've got a fund in place. It will build to $30 million annually and be predictable and ongoing for municipalities. So those are the kinds of changes that that we've made. And you know, I ran in the leadership and have built into our budgets each year commitment to infrastructure funding. And so the $15 billion of the Moving Ontario Forward Fund that's for outside of the GTHA is directly to address the challenges that that many of you face in terms of transportation and transit funding. We've recently, as you know, made a commitment to increase gas tax, to double the gas tax. Now, and I know that in combination with the OSIF funding, that's the kind of funding that you need. You need to be able to count on. So look forward to the questions. Just before we begin and I close, I will just say that I'm very aware that that the decisions that we make at Queen's Park have to be rooted in the concerns in each of your communities. And there's nothing at this point that is more top of mind in Ontario than electricity prices. I know that you're hearing it in your communities. MPPs around the province are hearing about electricity prices. And we're looking at how we can do three things. How we can address the reality that everybody has seen electricity prices go up, and how do we build on the 8% reduction, because we've taken the provincial portion of the HST off people's electricity prices, but how do we build on that and give some relief across the board? But in addition to that, how do we acknowledge in an increased reduction the disproportionate distribution charge that a lot of people are paying in some communities around the province, particularly in rural and northern areas. So that's the second area that we're looking at, figuring out how to remove some expense from the distribution charge and have a more even distribution charge across the province. And then thirdly, how do we, on top of that, address the reality that there are still people, even if we do those things, who are living on low incomes and will not be able to bear their electricity prices. So how do we make sure that we have everyone who is eligible in the Ontario Energy Support Program, and how do we make sure that we broaden the reach of that program. So we're looking at all of those things. We will bring a plan forward before the budget comes out in the spring, and I know that that's something that it's related to the infrastructure needs and the economic needs in your communities, because no matter how strong economic growth is, and there are parts of the province where economic growth is very strong, other parts where it's not so strong, if people can't pay their electricity bills, then they will not feel the benefit of that economic growth. So those are the things that we're tackling, and I'm happy to have a conversation with you, Allison. Thank you.
All right, great. Hello, everybody. Can everyone hear me? Yes? Okay. So let's flip back to infrastructure where you started
okay.
with. In the last spring budget, you pledged $137 billion for transit infrastructure over 12 years. And the federal government came in over the summer, not long after, with an additional $1.5 billion, which was being used as project incrementality funding. There's been some controversy and concerns that some municipalities are using the project incrementality funding to fund projects that weren't on the province's original priority list. Is that, or how will you be addressing that during phase two of the rollout of the overall infrastructure funding?
So this is an interesting conversation that we've been having with the federal government, and I will just say that it is great to have a federal government that wants to work with us on infrastructure funding, that sees the importance of that, and you know the reality is that because in Ontario we had already committed $160 billion over 12 years to infrastructure funding, which is a huge amount relative to what's been committed previously in Ontario. It's the largest single investment in infrastructure in Ontario's history. Having said that, when the federal government came in and they were bringing in new infrastructure money, we were already there. You know, we were already making investments, and so we had to talk about, so what's eligible, what's not eligible. And one of the challenges was that by putting a condition in place that projects had to be incremental, the reality was that there was already so much that was in the pipeline that was on our list, to then turn to municipalities and to say, you know, there have to be new projects. That was a challenge. So because we, you know, we had already worked with municipalities on where the highest needs projects were. On the second tranche, so we've sort of worked that out with the first in the first tranche of money, and there, you know, there may be some anomalies around the province, but for the most part that worked out well. We are now in the conversation with the federal government about the second tranche of funding, and you know, my hope is that we'll be able to find that compromise between what we know the projects are that need to be funded, what's already in our pipeline, and where the new money needs to go.
I'll switch gears a little bit, still in the infrastructure front. In her most recent report, Auditor General Bonnie Lysak was a bit rough on your government when it came to infrastructure money and how it was being spent, especially when it came to road paving contracts. This is something that Transportation Minister Steve Del Duca did address last week, which were some changes to the road tendering process that were meant to increase oversight of the tendering, stop some alleged fraud in the asphalt industry. And I'm wondering whether these changes will be enough to restore Ontarians' faith in Metrolinx's oversight and in how your government spends all of this infrastructure money that you're investing.
Well, I think that what's really important is that we take the advice of the experts and the recommendations. There are a number of recommendations, as you said, that have come forward. Minister Del Duca announced the action plan, and I've just noted some of the highlights of that action plan that we are acting on. So raising the benchmark for asphalt smoothing, conducting more inspections, requiring suppliers to certify high quality asphalt cement, and putting in place a panel of third party experts to advise the ministry on contract provisions. So I think some of those are very specific and concrete, if I can say. recommendations and actions that we're taking, but having the third panel advisory committee, having an ongoing process whereby we can monitor the implementation, I think is really important. Again, I know from my days as Minister of Transportation that the science of road building changes all the time. It's evolving, you know, and so we need to make sure that we're on top of it, make sure that we're doing the best science and hearing from the experts on how best to build our roads. And I think that this action plan will go a long way to doing that.
Were you shocked when you heard that the Auditor General's report on that? There were some anomalies in there, as you said in the your answer to the first question, but I mean, was that something that you had known was an issue out there?
So, I mean, the role of Auditors General and the role of the officers of the legislature is to look across government and to find the challenges that this huge multi-billion-dollar enterprise is facing. And so, where there are challenges, where there are gaps, that's where we need to step up and make sure that we're fixing those things. You know, so. Every single auditor's report that I've ever seen has got points to issues that government needs to address. So it is never a surprise to me when an auditor general says, you know what, here's something that needs work, here's something that's falling through the cracks, you need to get on that. And so we do that. And one of the things about the auditor general's report and the ombudsman and all of the officers of the legislature is that as they're writing their report, as they're putting their recommendations forward, they're working with the ministry officials to make sure that the track that the ministry officials are on is going to lead to a solution to the auditor's challenges. So I think that it is a really healthy part of our democracy, and I actually welcome the scrutiny of those officers of the legislature.
You do have a lot to look after.
Yeah, there's a lot, and I can remember, learning the new. Well, I'm not going to pretend I learned the new technologies of hot mix cement or hot mix asphalt or cold. I don't even have the language anymore because I've been the minister for a while. But there is so much science involved in the surfacing of roads and the building of roads that to stay on top of every single item. I mean, no premier is going to be able to do that. Mm-hmm. Ministers can do that. But we also need that. We need that scrutiny. We need those officers saying, look, there's something new that you should be looking at. And then we work with officials and come to the best outcome.
All right. Well, I'm going to stay on the topic of roads, but slightly differently.
We are Ontario Good
exactly,
Roads, so it's
yes.
All good.
So a recent controversy here in the city of Toronto and at Queen's Park was your, excuse my term, flip-flop on road tolling. Your new position is that tolling the Don Valley Parkway and the Gardiner Expressway is not appropriate until there's efficient and affordable transit available for everybody. But if the city of Toronto, you know, the biggest city in the province, is unable to find its own revenue generating tools, what does that mean for small and rural municipalities that are really desperate to find ways to raise money for themselves?
So those of you who would like to clap, go ahead and clap. I think that this whole discussion about revenue tools is a really challenging one, and I acknowledge that at AMO. I know my Minister of Municipal Affairs is here, Bill Morrow, and we've talked about this a lot. And I said at AMO that if municipalities or if AMO wanted to have a really robust discussion about which revenue tools they were interested in implementing, we were open to having that discussion. And I said the same thing to Mayor Tory. And I came into government in 2003 as an MPP, partly because I was so distressed by the lack of collegiality and the lack of cooperation between the previous government and municipalities, because I don't think that makes for good policy development. I think that there should be a strong working relationship. So my point there is I really do believe in the ability of municipalities to determine their fates to the greatest degree possible. So having said that, when John Tory raised the issue of tolls, what I said, I raised a couple of concerns. I said, there's been no regional discussion about this. So we have a GTHA mayor's table. He did not come to the mayor's table and talk about the issue of tolls. It was something that was thought about in isolation from the rest of the region. And I also said that as we had put high occupancy toll lanes on roads in Ontario, we've only done that where there are choices. So, you know, a high occupancy toll lane by definition means that you can drive in another lane. You've got another option. But with the Gardner and the DVP, what was being proposed was no option, certainly on the road, and the transit build-out has not happened yet. So people do not have an affordable option. So in fact, I've been pretty consistent on that there need to be options. Yes, it's something that we need to consider. I'm not philosophically opposed in any way, and neither is our government. We wouldn't have high occupancy toll lanes if we were. But I do believe that there has to be a consideration of affordability for all of the people who are going to use the road, and that means that there need to be options. We've brought forward what I think is a pretty strong solution in this case, and that is the doubling of the gas tax, which will benefit not only the City of Toronto, but about 100 municipalities around the province that will see more gas tax, more accessibility to money to make investments in transit. And that's something that I've heard from municipalities, not just the City of Toronto. So this discussion about revenue tools will go on. And as I say, I am not in any way opposed to the implementation of new revenue tools, but I do think there has to be a discussion about options, about affordability, and the impact on a region in the case of as densely a populated area as the GTHA.
Well, I'll throw you a bone on revenue tools, because there's one coming down the pipeline. The Ontario legislature began debating began second reading debate on Bill 65, the Safer School Zones Act, last week, which is being billed as a public safety measure. You know, for students cut to and fro from school mm-hmm. zones. But automated speed enforcement is also a way for some municipalities to generate revenue. So I wanted to know how quickly you guys were planning on moving forward with this bill, trying to get it passed.
Well, first of all, I mean, I know you framed it as it's being framed as a public safety. It actually is about, I have no idea what the revenue raised could possibly be. I have not seen any numbers in terms of what money could be raised either in the City of Toronto or elsewhere. What I do know is this was an issue that was raised by parents in communities right across the province. Ottawa, there were families who were very concerned about this. So it makes sense to me that we would use the cameras, first of all, the red light cameras, and also the radar, as an opportunity to create more safety in our community. So there's been a lot of discussion about pedestrian fatalities and injuries over the last couple of years, and so it seems to me that this is an important thing to move forward on, and we're moving ahead right now with it, and implementation should be very soon.
Great. All right, I'll switch gears a bit. So the problem of economic inequality has been getting a lot of play lately, especially with the election of Donald Trump south of the border. We heard Prime Minister Justin Trudeau discussing it quite publicly with Chancellor Angela Merkel in Germany last week or 2 weeks ago. Inequality and, you know, a resentment of the elites kind of has always had maybe a slightly different term in Ontario. We occasionally call it the urban-rural divide. And I mean, it's a different thing, but you know, not always completely different. I was wondering if, in your years as premier, do you think you've been successful in addressing the urban-rural divide, and what else needs to be done?
So let me just first say, I think your question does conflate two separate issues.
Okay.
Because I think income inequality exists in our rural communities, and income inequality exists in our urban and suburban communities. Some of the poorest people in the province live in both rural and urban communities. So I don't think that we can generalize in that way. I think that the unevenness of economic growth across the province is more regional than it is rural and urban. But I would say that I don't think I have been completely successful in bridging that rural-urban divide. I think that it is, on the one hand, real in the sense that people live differently in rural communities than they do in urban communities. Doesn't mean that that people in rural and urban communities don't have many of the same concerns. Everybody wants their kids to go to great schools, wants to have excellent health care for their families, wants to have the prospect of decent jobs and retirement security. You know, those are things that we share across all of our society, wherever you live in the province. But there are differences that can be exacerbated and rifts that can be increased by a look at, you know, how the economy is faring in different parts of the province. And so we have regional economic strategies. You know, one of the reasons that we have regional economic development funds is because there are different needs in different parts of the province, and there are different opportunities for investment in business, and there's a different degree of need to have that kind of government involvement. But it has meant that having the Southwestern Ontario Development Fund or the Northern Ontario Heritage Fund, it means that there are opportunities created in a way that they wouldn't be if government wasn't involved. And so we've tried to address some of those challenges. I also think that the rural-urban divide can be exploited for political means, you know? And the notion that somehow at Queen's Park we don't think about the North or we don't think about rural Ontario, it's just not true. I mean, we try very hard to address challenges. I'll give you an example of one that we're working on right now, and that is, how do we make sure that rural schools are not closed in a way that is going to really debilitate communities' economic development opportunities? And I've said to my colleagues, as we go into this budget, we need to have a strategy, because there are rural schools in this province that are absolutely necessary, or there are communities that need to have schools, whether it's the school that exists right now or whether it's a school that is created because the school boards work together or the school boards work with municipality to create a hub that has a school and has health services and has employment services all in one hub. That's the conversation that we need to have. So there will continue to be those kinds of different discussions, rural and urban, but that doesn't mean we have to stand in opposition to one another. It doesn't mean that the government is favoring one part of the province over another. It just means that there are different needs and we have to have different solutions depending on what part of the province we're talking about.
Okay, Joan. So I'm gonna go there. We're gonna talk about hydro.
So you and everyone else.
So the asset of, or the, sorry, the concept of asset recycling, although it has its opponents, is a fairly economically sound way to fund new infrastructure projects. And I wonder why you think your government has had such a hard time selling Hydro One privatization to the public when it is, you know, at its roots an asset recycling program, and whether or not you think you would have trouble selling other asset recycling programs in the future because this one has been so, you know, sticky for you guys.
Well, I think that we made it clear when we moved to broaden the ownership of Hydro One that this was the action that we were taking, that we said we were going to be looking at. We said we were going to be looking at assets, as you say. We said we were going to be looking at how we could leverage existing assets that were owned by the people of Ontario to build new assets that will be owned by the people of Ontario. And so the decision around Hydro One was just that. We wanted to be able to follow through on our commitment to build infrastructure, to build transit infrastructure around the province, and to build roads and bridges and all of that infrastructure that people need. And so part of that $160 billion commitment was to look at the assets in the province. And I think that there were ideologies attached to, or certainly that were targeted at that decision. You know, I think there are ideologies around privatization that suggest that somehow the private sector really shouldn't have a role to play with government at all. I mean, in the same way that, you know, we've been able to build so much of our infrastructure because we've worked with the private sector. And in this case, we, you know, we needed to be able to move that asset into a different category in order to be able to build new assets. So I, you know, I think that it's the right decision. Obviously, I wouldn't have made it. It was a tough decision, but I wouldn't have made that decision with my colleagues if we didn't, if I hadn't believed that it was the right one. But I do think that there were some who saw it as an opportunity to take an ideology and then move to conflate two issues. So to say that by broadening the ownership of Hydro One, using the money that we access in order to build infrastructure, that somehow that was going to increase electricity prices, when in fact, that's not what has increased electricity prices. I mean, there are very good reasons that electricity prices have gone up in Ontario. We've made huge investments in electricity infrastructure. We closed the coal-fired plants. We've built new capacity. That's what has increased electricity prices in Ontario. So we have a clean, reliable grid, but those increased electricity prices have nothing to do with the broadening of the ownership of Hydro One. So that's the challenge that we're dealing with right now, is to de-link those issues, because they are not related. And in fact, you know, the one of the opposition parties brought forward a plan today.
That was going to be my last question.
Yeah, and you know, have said that the one thing that has to happen is that the sale of Hydro One has to stop. That won't take 1 cent off one person's bill. So to suggest that somehow that's what's driving electricity prices is just, it's just not the case. And so there are other things that we need to do, and we'll bring a plan forward, but that's not what's driving electricity prices.
Yeah, maybe we should just give some context for people in the room who haven't been, you know, following the news cycle frantically today. NDP leader Andrea Horwath announced that if she is elected premier, she would repurchase all of the Hydro One shares that have been privatized as a way of lowering electricity prices, among other things. It's a larger plan, but yeah,
and
I
guess
want to
the
get
question,
your initial response.
Yeah, the
to
question.
That.
Well, the question then becomes: so, what happens then to the infrastructure plan? You know, because if you focus on that as the priority, then the infrastructure plan becomes secondary. And I think that is very wrong-headed. I think that, you know, if it did significantly lower electricity prices, then it might be something to look at. But we wouldn't have gone into it if it was going to increase electricity prices. So I think it's a very, very wrong-headed direction and would cause a lot of problems in terms of our ability as a province to foster economic growth. We know, Allison, when I travel to other countries and we talk about, we talk to companies about coming here, about locating here, or about expanding their businesses here, one of the things they ask about is infrastructure. They want to know that they can move their goods. They want to know that when they hire people here, that they're going to be able to move around, that their employees are going to have a quality of life that is high. And part of that is good modern infrastructure. If we can't continue to build that infrastructure in every part of the province, we are going to fall behind. And remember, we're playing catch up, because there had been years, and this is not a partisan comment, because it had been all party stripes that had not invested in infrastructure. If we'd been rebuilding and building the roads and the bridges and the transit every year that we needed to, we wouldn't have been in the really strongly deficit position that we were in 2003 when we came into office. So we have to keep that building, and there's nothing in the NDP plan that would indicate how she would continue to do that. And what's even more egregious is that strategy would not lower electricity prices.
All right, well, we are out of time.
Okay, all right. Okay.
Thank you very much, Premier.
Thank you very much. Thanks, everybody. Merci. Thank you.
Hang on. Well, that was a very refreshing format. And Madam Premier, we very much appreciated Ontario Good Roads, your attendance and your time with us today and sharing your thoughts. And thank you to Allison as well.
Thank you. Have a
appreciate
great conference, everybody.
Good afternoon, everyone. Small change to your program this afternoon. I am not the one and only Ken Lupe from the city of Brampton. My name is Tom Bateman. I'm the Director of Transportation Services for the County of Essex. And I certainly have the pleasure this afternoon of introducing our next session. And again, living and working in the shadow of the great state of Michigan, I'm very excited to be part of this discussion that we've entitled Ontario's Prospects in the Age of Trump. Our first speaker for you this afternoon is Chris Sands. Chris is the director of the Canadian Studies at Johns Hopkins University. Professor Sands has come to be known as the go-to person in the United States for understanding Canadian-American relations. Last fall's American elections have seemed to create some uncertainty, and hopefully this afternoon, Professor Sands will be able to give us some insights from Washington, calm some of our frayed nerves, or perhaps temper one's excitement, depending on where you stand. So would you please help me welcome Chris Sands.
Thank you very much, Tom. So they told me I could speak like this. I feel like Phil Donahue without the hair. And certainly when I speak to a class, I don't have the theater in the round or even this many people paying attention. What I wanted to do is talk a little bit about the US election and what I think it may mean for you. And then as I understand it, I'll have like people appear behind me and they'll pick me apart and make fun of everything that I said. So hopefully this will be sort of the raw meat part of the conversation. For Canadians watching the American election, as I'm sure all of you were, the first thing that's striking about Donald Trump, other than his very bad hair, is that, like mine actually, mine's sort of a little more natural, is that it seems like a radical departure from what we thought we knew about the United States. He's a very different kind of leader, he's got a very different approach to tweeting, and he seems very disruptive of what we used to know. But what I'd like to emphasize is that in a way, Donald Trump is very consistent with the kind of leaders that Americans have wanted to have going back to the end of the Cold War. At the first post-Cold War election, we had the chance to elect Bill Clinton. What the American people wanted at the end of the Cold War were three important things: an economy that was growing, less military engagement abroad, because the Cold War was expensive and it took a lot of blood and treasure, so we wanted to have less of that expenditure, more time to invest at home. And third, we wanted less of the partisanship that seemed to emerge. And those of you who remember the Clinton administration will remember that we did get less military engagement, although by the end, Yugoslavia, Rwanda, there were cases that were beginning to worry us a little bit, that it wasn't going to be all easy after the end of the Cold War. But we did get economic growth, which is reasonably good. By the end of the Clinton years, we had the partisanship back with a vengeance, with the attempt to impeach President Clinton, Monica Lewinsky, the whole scandal. The American people nonetheless wanted what they wanted, and so in the next election, they picked George W. Bush, who ran saying, I'm a uniter, not a divider, I'm gonna bring people together, I'm gonna focus on the economy, we're gonna nation build at home and not overseas. And then we had 9/11. And by the end of President Bush's term, we had moved from that moment in the election where we wanted what we wanted, and we had the financial crisis that disrupted the economy. We'd had Iraq, which was the kind of military engagement we didn't want, although Afghanistan may have been necessary, but it seemed to be carrying on and with no end in sight. And we had partisanship, because you'll remember with George W. Bush, there was bitter partisanship between Democrats and Republicans, particularly towards the end of his two terms. And so the American people wanted the exact same thing again and elected Barack Obama, who said that he believed there were no red states, no blue states, only the United States of America. He was going to focus on the economy, and he was going to keep the U.S. from getting involved in conflicts overseas. And while we droned people during the Obama years, we didn't have a major war, but we did have a relatively weak recovery and we also had lots of partisan bitterness. So at the end of this period, the American people, being remarkably consistent, went into this last election looking for the same things that they always looked for. They wanted the economy to get going, less partisanship, and they wanted less engagement abroad. And the choice of Donald Trump really resonates with that agenda. Donald Trump offered equal opportunity abuse for Republicans and Democrats in the establishment. He had no use for any of them. And I say that having lived in Washington, D.C. for a long enough time that I probably am part of the establishment. Now, he hasn't tweeted about me per se, but he probably doesn't like me by just sort of instinct. Professors are never all that trustworthy. But we rejected the establishment. Donald Trump seemed to be transcending partisanship by being an equal opportunity critic of both sides. Then we had the focus on the economy. Let's build the economy at home. He wants to unleash not only the stock market, but return us to 3.5%, maybe 4% economic growth. And if he does, a lot will be forgiven, because that will make people very, very happy in the United States, for sure. But also to focus on those people who, during the Clinton years and the Bush years and even the Obama years, seem to have been left behind by our trade agenda and even by our environmental agenda. People who, when we signed on to NAFTA, felt that the establishment had changed the deal. Yes, we supported free trade with countries like Canada that had comparable labor standards, comparable environmental standards, comparable wage rates, but Mexico was a whole different thing. The wage rates were not comparable, and many Americans felt that this would mean that our jobs would go south to Mexico and we would lose out, as indeed appeared to happen. At the same time, on the environment, presidents like President Clinton and even President Bush and President Obama took us from the era of the 50-cent light bulb that you picked up at the drugstore to a $5 light bulb, from cheap gas to expensive gas because of gasoline taxes, all to move us to address climate change. But for many people whose energy demand in the short run is inelastic, this meant a bigger chunk out of their pocketbook. Donald Trump seemed to promise a return to focusing on the economy of the ordinary person, the person who'd been left behind by trade, who'd been hard done by our environmental policies, and who felt that the economy wasn't working for them. But most importantly, what Donald Trump offered was a return to a nationalistic view, what he calls America First, in which the United States would rally as a nation. Now, we're a very diverse country, as Canada is, but his pledge was, as he said in his inaugural, that there's no room for bigotry with true patriots, that we're all in this together as Americans, and we're going to find a way to get out of it. There's a real appeal to that for many Americans, the idea that we are all in this together and that we're going to work together, and we're not going to let the establishment necessarily push around average Americans. I say that because the worst thing about Donald Trump for, I think, some Canadians is the fear that not only is Donald Trump strange, but that it means the American people are strange. And you all know Americans, probably hundreds of them. And what I wanted to emphasize in this whole flow is that the American people haven't changed. They want the same things. They're frustrated. They haven't gotten them from the leaders we've had so far since the end of the Cold War, and they're hoping they can get them from Donald Trump. Now, many of the people who elected Donald Trump were baby boomers, my parents' generation. And the baby boomers have now had four presidents in a row, because Clinton was a baby boomer, Bush was a baby boomer, Obama was a baby boomer, and now we have Donald Trump. And this generation has been the largest voting bloc since the end of the Cold War. They've driven most of our elections, with the possible exception of this last one. In this last election, had they shown up, the millennial generation could have been the biggest voting bloc. They didn't show up. Many of them stayed home. They thought Hillary Clinton, who they didn't love that much, was nonetheless safe, and they didn't show up. So now the challenge for many millennials is to figure out, what's the lesson of this election for us? What does it mean? Does it mean that we have to go into new elections politically active so it never happens like this again? Or do we recognize, maybe differently, that politics is a rigged game, we hate politics, we're going to start an NGO and have nothing to do with those parties we can't stand, which would suggest more upheaval in American politics. So millennial generation is very important. It's also very important to the baby boomers, who are largely their parents. The baby boomers in the United States don't think they're going to get a manufacturing job back that they lost with NAFTA. They're not crazy. In fact, most of them are retiring now, and they've had a long career, and it may not have been everything they wanted. Even those who are mad about trade aren't unrealistic enough to think that that job is coming back. They want Donald Trump to deliver an economy that works for their children. And for many millennials, the fear about the American economy is it's not going to produce the jobs, the opportunity, the chance, as we say with the American dream, to do better than your parents did and continue to move forward economically. And a lot of young people are worried about their college debt, they're worried about the country, the divisions in the country, and how we can move forward. So a second thing about this election, which is I think the other shoe to drop, is what will millennials take from this election and how will they participate going forward? Donald Trump is 70 now, he may run for re-election, but it's a safe bet we won't have two baby boomers in the next election in 2020. And it's an even safer bet that we won't have a choice between two baby boomers in the following election in 2024. So American politics are changing, and they're changing in an important way. So what does that mean for politics and, more importantly, for Canada-US relations going forward? The first thing is that Donald Trump, as near as we can tell, has very little negative view at all about Canada. Some of you may remember that there was a week when the president was tweeting negatively about General Motors opening a plant in Mexico. Then he had a negative tweet about Ford doing the same thing. Then he even tweeted against Toyota opening a plant in Mexico, saying it was the wrong direction. And then Honda announced that they were going to be expanding their plant here in Alliston, Ontario. And there was tweet silence. And I think that silence is significant because what it says is that for Donald Trump, opening a plant in Canada was not a threat. It was not something he disapproved of. He views Canada differently than he views Mexico. I think he's a little harsh on Mexico personally, but I think his views of Canada are relatively positive. When you talk to people who he knows about Canada, including Canadians he knows personally, they always emphasize the same thing. Canada is the United States' number one customer. If you're going to make America great again, if you want to boost American exports, the place to start is Canada. Except that Canada generally is doing well, so don't mess it up. And I think the president has a certain caution regarding Canada. Now, this is an old American tradition, one that goes back a long way. And some years ago, back in the Clinton days, I was working with the Center for Strategic and International Studies, a think tank in DC that I still do some work for. And we had an amazing conference. This was right after the 1994 election. And Newt Gingrich was the newly elected Speaker of the House, still a Trump advisor. And I remember the moment very clearly. Because we'd invited him to give a speech. He gave a speech with lots of references to Cicero, ancient Rome, all sorts of grandiose commentaries. And then we opened it up to Q&A. And there was someone in the audience who asked, over the weekend, Speaker Gingrich, you talked about the need to go to war with China if necessary to defend Taiwan. That was way farther than American foreign policy has been willing to go. What were you thinking? And the Speaker Gingrich said, well, I thought it was important that the Chinese know that behind the wishy-washy Bill Clinton, there was real steel in the Congress. I thought I'd play the Vladimir Zhirinovsky role. Now, I don't know if you remember Vladimir Zhirinovsky, but he was the communist leader in post-Soviet Union Russia, who was not a nice guy. But that was how Gingrich thought. You know, you gotta be tough. The second question, this was 94, remember, after the election and before we turned over to 95. The second question was not from me, I guarantee it, but it was a question about what was his view about the Quebec referendum in 95? Did he think it was important for the US to be neutral? Should the US support an independent Quebec? And Speaker Gingrich, who just previously was talking about war with China, shifted and then said very meekly, I believe the US has always had a strong relationship with a united Canada, but the future of Canada is for Canadians to decide, and I don't want to be involved. War with China, okay, but on Canada, he stuck to the State Department line. And that's because of, I don't want to say the reverence, but the respect that people have in the United States for the importance of a good relationship with Canada. Now, the president is committed to trying to get us to 3.5, 4% growth if he can. If he does, he'll be forgiven a lot of things, including some of his tweets and some of his rude comments. Growth is good for both of our countries. But as he tries to move forward, there are a number of things that I think we could do between Canada and the U.S. that would make the relationship work better. Just a short list for you, because then we'll get onto the panel and it'll be more give and take. First, I think with Donald Trump, we're going to see a return to an idea that has been part of Canada-U.S. relations in the past, which is the idea of exemptionalism. After World War II, we frequently had issues that would come up in Canada-U.S. relationship, and at the instigation of the Canadians, they would say, well, we can't believe the U.S. is slapping this tariff on all imports. We can't believe the Americans are going to demand that the Europeans do this or that. It's going to hurt our economy. And American presidents from Harry Truman, Dwight Eisenhower, Lyndon Johnson would respond by saying, oh, yeah, we didn't mean Canada. We were doing something international, but we forgot about Canada. We didn't mean it, so we would exempt you from the application of the provision. Congress did the same thing. They'd pass a law, didn't mean to hit Canada. People in the Midwest states would say, this is really hurting our trade. Congress would amend the legislation and exempt Canada from the application of the new rule. Now, from an academic point of view, and I know everybody hates academics once you get out of school, we used to say this is a bad idea because it meant that Canada was treated so specially that it didn't fit into anybody else's theories. But right now, it would be a good idea. Because I think there are a number of things the U.S. is doing or wants to do to reset its economic relationships worldwide that would be very destructive of our relationship with Canada, including a border tax, including some of the new immigration provisions that are being discussed. And where Canada can be exempted, it preserves the relationship that works. And I think for Donald Trump, who doesn't think a lot about Canada but doesn't want to mess it up, exempting you from a rule is better than having it hit you and hit us at the same time. Does that mean that we won't do stupid things? No, it just means we won't do them to you, which is at least something. A second thing that I think is more worrisome for me is the focus on linkage. The president is a negotiator. He wheels and deals. He gives and takes. And so the challenge here is that he'll say, we can do a deal on softwood lumber for you guys in Canada, but we want something in return. Now, traditionally, Canadian diplomats have said linkage is a bad idea because Canada only has so many cards to play, and eventually, you'll run out of things. And so the president will say, I'll give you a deal on softwood lumber. Can you send 10,000 troops to help fight the Islamic State? Or 10,000 troops to help me with my war against China, God forbid. And that you'll be in a jam, and you won't want to do it, but that we will have put you in a box. Those are the kinds of deals we want to avoid. And I think the president, because he doesn't have a great grounding in Canada-U.S., may try to do trade-offs that put you on the defensive. And it'll be very tricky for the Trudeau government to manage it, even though I'd give them very high marks for the way in which they've managed their relationships with Donald Trump so far, about which we can talk if you'd like. So there's good news and bad news in that. The third piece of news I think is the most interesting, but it's the one that I think will preoccupy us for the next couple of years, and that is what we're going to do to the existing relationships that we have, whether it's renegotiating NAFTA or trying to engage in a U.S. infrastructure program that could bring back the specter of Buy American. How do we go to those programs without so upsetting the apple cart in terms of our Canadian trade and our economic and investment relationships that we do serious long-term damage? And I think it's going to take all of us who have goodwill about this relationship to navigate this period. So first on NAFTA renegotiation. The best case for NAFTA renegotiation for Canada is that we go back to the table and we incorporate into NAFTA all the things we've been negotiating on since NAFTA. In a way, we've always been renegotiating NAFTA. NAFTA itself set up 12 working groups on different sectors of the economy. We're civil servants in all three NAFTA countries. We're supposed to align regulations to create a single market for goods, services, investment across North America. The NAFTA working groups were set up in the wake of the NAFTA ratification debate in the United States, which is about as controversial for us as your Canada's free trade agreement debate was for you. And out of that, we set them up, but the civil servants, especially the Americans, felt that the political climate wasn't right to make big concessions to Canada, let alone Mexico, and so the working groups didn't accomplish much. So when George W. Bush was in office, he set up the Security and Prosperity Partnership for North America, 10 working groups on security cooperation, which was particularly important because border security became a market access barrier for Canadians getting into the U.S. market after 9/11, for sure, but also 10 working groups on economic and prosperity issues that worked away on aligning regulations and cooperating more on getting the economy going. And after the Bush administration, Barack Obama came in and decided dual bilateral was best. So we had a beyond the border agreement with US and Canada to work on border and security issues, and we had the Regulatory Cooperation Council to deal with regulatory alignment. We had this parallel discussions with the Mexicans. So we continued, but on two tracks. Then President Obama suggested in the Trans-Pacific Partnership negotiations that Canada and Mexico join, and we update our North American arrangements for the 21st century in the context of the TPP. President Trump has said he wants to withdraw American participation in the TPP, but we still have already negotiated some changes to our North American arrangements that all three countries have agreed to that we could incorporate. So take the agendas of all those things, all the things that we've been discussing for 23, 24 years, and fold them into the new and improved NAFTA. That sounds like more than a tweak, but it's less than a twerk, so it's good, and we would have a new North American Free Trade Agreement. If US-Mexico relations don't go well, and they certainly aren't off to a great start, you could fold all of that into the Canada-US Free Trade Agreement, which still exists on the books. But I think the opportunity to do it in NAFTA is really important. Some of you will know there's an energy chapter in Canada-US Free Trade. There's an energy chapter in NAFTA. But both only deal with Canada and the US. Mexico would not submit energy to the negotiating table just as Canada reserved culture off the table in Canada-US Free Trade. That was the understanding. But now that Mexico's opened up its energy sector, there's a huge opportunity for energy-related infrastructure and technology transfer and participation by Canadian and American companies in the Mexican market. We ought to bring that under the NAFTA discipline. At the same time, we created in NAFTA a North American Free Trade Visas program, the NAFTA visa, as you call it here. We call it the TN visa in the US. The NAFTA visa was supposed to make it easier for business people to go back and forth across the border and certain professionals because their credentials would be recognized. It hasn't achieved a huge amount. It's not bad. We could move towards allowing business travelers the same freedom to enter each other's countries that we allow tourists. You want to go and look for a job or meet a client or go to a convention? You can do it for up to 3 months without a visa as long as you're not permanently relocating. And if you want to permanently relocate, there's a process. But make it easier for people to go back and forth across the border, boost tourism for a change, and get the economy going. I think this would be certainly doable, at least between Canada and the US. And on regulatory alignment, particularly between Canada and the US, I think there's room for us to do mutual recognition. When Australia and New Zealand began what was the predecessor of the TPP, their own mutual recognition agreement on regulation, they didn't try to change the regulations that Australia had or New Zealand had. They simply recognized that functionally, they're the same. They functionally are equivalent, even though they're minor differences. And then they asked their civil servants to say, what do you think isn't really functionally equivalent? And there were some lists of objections that were put forward. I think that New Zealanders were very lenient on the regulation of hobbits. Koala bears got a pass in Australia, so they had to make some changes. They put a list together of the things they felt they weren't aligned on, and the negotiators just worked on that smaller list. But you had immediate recognition across the border. I think that this would be really possible between Canada and the US. Not necessarily easy, but possible, where a business that had received approval for their product or service in Canada could enter the US and say, look, I'm good, because I've gone through the process in Canada. Particularly when you're dealing with an administration that wants to cut red tape, get rid of two regulations for every one regulation you want to bring out that's new, saying to Donald Trump, we can make Canada-US economics work better by providing mutual recognition for each other's standards for fertilizer, standards for building safety, because many of them are functionally equivalent, even if they have some minor differences. And that would be a great way to move the economy forward and, as the president likes to say, make America great again, but do so in a way that includes Canada. So I think that there's a lot of potential in this new relationship. When I'm in a classroom or when I'm talking to a group like this, I really feel that the reason that Canada and the United States do get along and have gotten along so well is not because our president and prime minister are friends, not because our Congress and our parliament are friends, not because governors and premiers are friends, but because the people of the United States and the people of Canada are friends and like each other. We have lots of friends and relatives that go back and forth across the border. That's the fundamental part of this relationship, and that hasn't changed. And the Americans you know have not changed. They're still committed to the same things: a less militaristic engagement in the world, economic growth, and less partisanship. What remains to be seen is whether this new administration and the Congress that came in with them will disappoint Americans just like every one of the past three presidents, or we'll do better. And as an American, and I hope you those of you who are Canadian and have goodwill for the United States, I hope this one is different. I hope we succeed. But if we don't, we'll need your help to try to put this back together in 4 years or maybe eight. So with that, thank you very much. And I guess there's a panel.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much, Chris. Thank you very much, Chris. It certainly gives us lots to think about. And if we can say it's an interesting time at the very least.
At the very least.
So I'd like to just take a second to introduce the rest of our panel this afternoon. I'd first like to welcome to the stage, joining Chris will be Sandra Pupatello. Sandra is certainly no stranger to the Ontario Good Roads Association, having served as a Minister of Economic Development and Trade. Sandra is currently the Strategic Advisor, Global Markets and Public Sector for PwC Canada. PwC provides industry-focused assurance, advisory, and tax services to the public, private, and government clients in all markets. We're also very pleased to welcome Warren Kinsella, President of the Daisy Group. Previously, he was a partner with the law firm of McMillan Binch in its public policy group, and has worked as a consultant, journalist, and was political chief of staff. In the early 90s, Warren held the position of special assistant to the Right Honorable Jean Chrétien, the leader of the Liberal Party. And hiding behind me here, joining Chris, Sander, and Warren is Ontario Good Roads Association's own manager of policy and research, Scott Butler, who is definitely here to make moderating great again. So please welcome your panel.
Seems like an auspicious title to have foisted on me. Chris laid out a vision, I think, that we just heard of the relationship between Canada and the U.S. that's largely, I think, pragmatic and optimistic. I'm wondering, initial response to that, how do you feel, Sandra? You've been working on this both as a Minister of Economic Development and as well as in the private sector. How do you feel about the future?
Well, I'm trying to gauge sort of who's in the crowd. I love to see my colleagues here from my home county in the front row, I noticed. Beards and all. It's like a trend with this beard thing. I think George Clooney's had an attack on Windsor-Essex County these days. I do think generally I watched the election with obviously the same kind of mystery that most Canadians did. So I'm like everyone else in being shocked, watching with wonder. As a director of a multinational company, I was very worried during the election because we have a lot of plants in the U.S. and what does that mean for us? So depending on what seat you're in at the moment, you're going to think differently. From an economic perspective for Canada, I am very worried, and I need to see that all of our leadership at both the provincial, municipal, and federal levels pull out all the stops right now and for the next 2 years. That generally, until that first series of elections, which will be in 2 years, that we're going to see those congressional seats are either going to flip Democrat because they're all appalled, or they're going to maintain Republicans because they're all good with this. This is our time, these 2 years right here. So either get it all done right now in the next 2 years, because if they keep the Republicans, they will implement everything that they've been talking about in the slogans that Trump has been spouting for months. If they change, then obviously we're going to take a downer in 2 years and not worry so much about it, because it'll be sort of the same. So that's what I think. And what I'm seeing in terms of our federal government being quite active, and I've been involved in the outreach that they've had to actually sit down with them, what sectors, who needs to talk, who's the best person to be saying this message, et cetera, et cetera. I'm glad to see that. I don't know, honestly, what some of the local or provincial governments are doing in that regard, if they're doing it to that extent, mostly because it's still new. I think they're going to get at it, but it's still pretty new. So I generally worry about it every day. I watch CNN every day. I never used to do that. I'm losing sleep, actually, because I have to watch Stephen Colbert every night. And if I missed any of the tweets of the day, I get them repeated to me in some very funny fashion by Stephen Colbert. Also behavior that I did not have before the election. So that gives you any indication about how seized I am of this. I really am. I worry tremendously about the competitive edge of Canada, of Ontario in particular, with the sectors that the new administration in the US has selected to focus on. They're focusing on Ontario sectors. I lose sleep over that.
Have you been inflected with the same neuroses and TV watching habits that Sandra has?
I've always been neurotic.
Okay.
There we go. But I have an envelope from the Academy. No, I got it. No, it's real. I'm not making this up. So let me read these out. So the first one is, Hillary Clinton is president after all. And this one is, this one's even better. The Leafs won the Stanley Cup.
Now, you know he's doing that because I spent some time with PwC, right?
And I didn't mention PwC. Oscars. She did. So.
All to say, the minute there was, do you know these guys had to memorize every single winner? And imagine the guy from PwC when they announced the wrong name. The guy went flying out of his seat. I can't even imagine what that was like.
Okay. It's like working for Donald Trump.
Right. What's coming out next?
I'm up here to be the shit disturber. I do not have as rosy a view as Mr. Sands. I think probably like a lot of people, share some of Sandra's anxiety about what has happened. And what's extraordinary, I'll just speak for a couple minutes and then we can get into some more. It's only been a month. Like, it's just been a month, and it feels like a lifetime. There's been anti-Muslim bans. There has been, I had to write them down because there's been so many. He's had assorted scandals, mainly about Russia. He's had high-level resignations. He has protests drawing millions, including my wife and my daughter went down to Washington to protest. And there's been this bottomless well of chaos and confusion. And it really does feel like it has gone on forever. Like, it's amazing. And so the thing, all of us here, I think, talk to people in Ottawa. When he was coming in, how do you deal with this guy? Because none of us expected, I certainly didn't expect he was going to be president of the United States. And the thing that is predictable about Donald Trump is he's unpredictable. You literally do not know what he's going to say or what he's going to do at any given moment. And in fact, a lot of us have been reduced to getting up in the morning and putting on the coffee and checking out Twitter to see what the lunatic said on Twitter at 3 o'clock in the morning. This is how we're learning about global affairs and trade policy and important things that affect all of our lives. That obviously isn't the way things are supposed to happen, but it is. The one thing that you can say about him, and I'm a student of the political beast, I've had the great fortune to work for and with amazing people like Sandra and Mr. Kretzian and Dalton McGuinty and so on, is I study the political animal. And, you know, he's certainly unpredictable. But the one thing you can say, almost to his credit, is he's done what he said he was going to do. He said he was going to, I did a list again. He said he was going to stop Muslims from entering the United States. He's doing it. He said he is going to kill or rewrite trade deals, which I suspect we're going to talk about. He's doing it. He hasn't served notice to Congress yet, but he's doing it. He said he's going to build a wall on the border with Mexico. He's doing it. He signed two executive orders, in fact, to facilitate that. He's reversed course on Keystone XL, which is good. I'm from Alberta, so I support that. But the Dakota Access Pipeline, that is going to be a never-ending source of conflict. He started dismantling Obamacare. So I'll stop here, but the thing about Trump, along with his unpredictability, and Bannon said this at the CPAC conference last week, and it was the one part that everybody needs to focus on. If you want to know what Donald Trump's going to do next week or next month or next year, just look at his promises. Because I guess to his credit, he is making good on his promises. And if that's so, what that means for Canada and the world is a lot of chaos.
So
What's the opportunity, because this is focusing largely on the federal level, what's the opportunity for subnational governments, whether it's municipalities, city-to-city arrangements, provinces and states to work together? Is there a workaround or an opportunity presented for those governments to succeed under this?
Well, and I think that's the big question. What are we going to do about it? Because we can't dig in our heels and say, you can't do that. That's not up to us to have them stop. Sure. So they're going to just keep doing it. I do think we have to stop reacting every day as if we're kind of, oh, you want to negotiate NAFTA? Sure, I'll be right there. Like, for God's sake, let's not completely pander to what they might want to do, because it's not necessarily good for us. So I tend to be a little bit more bullish on the Canada position. You know, first of all, we're quite an excellent buffer between the US and Russia, and at least half of America will be really happy about that. So that's a good positioning for us. Second, we supply the US with 40% of their crude oil. That is a key energy source for the lion's share of America. Also a very good bargaining position. So when we take, whether it's some of our food supply, our water supply, we have some very, very key positions that we're not wearing it on our sleeve, and maybe we don't just yet. So I'm not the one that's sort of the master negotiator, but I have been involved enough to know what some of those key elements are that make Canada very special in the eyes of America. What I think we need to figure out is who in America should be doing the talking about Canada, and it's not Canadians. So let's get that straight. No one cares what we think. They don't care what the Mexicans think either, but they will care what Americans care about. And so we do need to find who the champions are of the Mexican condition as well as the Canadian condition, and sometimes they're going to be both. So for example, that is going to be automotive, which I know well. For example, if they were going to go ahead and renegotiate NAFTA, or if they were going to go ahead and implement these border taxes, you know who's going to lose more jobs and more tax revenue as a result is the American government and the American people. And that's simply because it is the best example of a totally integrated system that as soon as you add a tax, it will be passed on to the consumer, the prices ultimately will rise, the sales automatically will decrease, which will automatically mean less sales, therefore less production, therefore layoffs. It's just a cycle that is the cycle. There's no American political slogan that was ever used during the political presidential campaign that talked about that cycle, but that's the cycle. So as soon as they figure that out, I suspect that it is suddenly going to become something else, and it will not become a tax that's going to impact that sector. You know, I was in Mexico seeing that Ford plant was not being built long before they announced they weren't going to build it. Just so you know, I saw it because we have a plant right near there, and everybody there knew it wasn't going to go ahead, and it wasn't going ahead because sales for that particular product destined for that plant were not moving, so they couldn't validate moving forward with the plant. Now, the fact that they took advantage of that singularly to show Trump that they were going to sort of succumb to the master and say, okay, we won't build that plant. I mean, I was a little, it was like being cuckolded. It was just not pleasant to watch that. I didn't enjoy that at all, because I knew that they weren't going to do that.
Chris, we have neighbors up here, by the way. Sandra, obviously, being from Windsor. Chris is from Detroit. How do you, if there are two intertwined communities that might model this example, it would certainly be those. What do you see from the American perspective for provinces, states, cities?
You know, I think one of the interesting things for us will be watching the relationship between Congress and the president. Yeah. If you go back the last couple of Congresses, the Congresses have really not been very functional. We had periods during the Obama years where rather than passing a budget, they did a continuing resolution because they couldn't agree on the budget. The most fundamental thing a Congress is supposed to do, they weren't doing budgets. They spent a lot of time wasting their breath on investigations and things that went nowhere. And I think it's been really hard for Republicans, in particular in the House, to discipline the Freedom Caucus or the Tea Party Caucus, however they style themselves, because they've really wanted to upset the system and they've not been committed to making it work. Donald Trump has seemed to be able to bring that caucus to heel in support of what Paul Ryan wants to do, and much of what Donald Trump wants to do in terms of tax reform and so on is going to require cooperation in Congress. If that relationship is functional,
It could mean a lot for states and communities because they'll have clarity on funding, we'll have budgets that make sense, and we'll begin to deal with some of the tax and also debt issues that the US faces. So that's the upside. In the medium term, I think there will be a lot of people who are going to look to Canada as a partner, as an insurance policy against the chaos. So what can we do with the Canadians? So I know there are a number of firms that were involved in sort of clean energy, and during the Obama years, you could get various subsidies and tax breaks for pursuing clean energy R&D. That's not on the agenda now. Where are you going to go? Well, you could take your project, and if it's viable enough, maybe find a Canadian partner and carry that idea and that innovation into Canada. You're looking to build projects and you want to say, this isn't just my local thing, you know, I've got a bunch of Democratic senators, I want to appeal to Republicans. Look, we're doing this with the Canadians and find ways to engage and sort of stabilize the relationship. This is where I think the peace, order, and good government Canadians value, which leads to a sort of desire for stability and rationality, clashes with peace, order, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. We want both liberty and happiness, which are often at odds, and we're going to get more chaos. But your stability will be appealing as a partner on a number of issues for states, for municipal governments, for others who are looking to get away from some of the chaos.
Do you want to jump in?
Dr. Sands, I think it's fair to say that that's the Indiana governor who's to say that, or the Michigan governor, because, again, it's who says that is critical. So if Michigan, who just handed seats over to the Republicans for, you know, which was a surprise. If that governor says, hey, this Canadian-Ontario relationship is key, don't screw this up for me, that's a very important message for Trump to hear,
sure.
More so than hearing it from the Ontarians.
And Vice President Pence is a former Indiana governor, had reasonably good relationships with your premier and with others in Canada. So he seems to be playing an important role. I think he has a sense of the value of the relationship. Mm-hmm. Rex Tillerson does. Certainly Secretary Mattis, our defense secretary, mm-hmm. has an appreciation for Canada as an ally. So there are ways in which people around Trump, I think, have a better understanding of Canada than he
does. Well, and that's that sort of, if it slows down, that's great, because as we hurdle closer to that 2-year mark, then we're gonna know go, no go.
Yeah.
These things actually are gonna happen. So if I were, you know, I would try to throw a spanner in the wheel. Like, how do you slow this down to draw it closer to the 2-year mark so you really know they're serious and they're going to do these things?
Can I disagree with you slightly on that?
You wanna jump in, Warren? Sorry.
Oh, yeah, sorry.
Give me a minute. How many of you work for or with municipal governments in this province?
All of them.
Right? So the one thing that you guys know is that business and money dislike unpredictability. And that is, I think we all agree, is a characteristic of this guy's personality. So we can lament that and we can be concerned about that. And we can do psychological profiles of members of his cabinet, but they all seem to be kind of crazy too, in my opinion. So take advantage of it. Like in the early days, the executive order on the Muslim ban, the principal opponents to that within the United States, so not the Democratic Party, it was Apple and Microsoft, because their workforce disproportionately relies upon, they're the United Nations, two of the biggest companies in the world. Well, maybe they are the biggest companies in the world. And Trump has a tin ear about that, and so too is his government. You guys can take advantage of that. You know, we've got competitive tax rates. We've got this highly trained, highly educated workforce. We should be moving in as a country and as a province and subnational governments like yours to take advantage of that and say, hey, look up here. You're not going to have any of that kind of crazy with us. You're going to have a stable environment, and we have health care, and we have infrastructure. We have all these things that you're seeking in the United States. Donald Trump is not going to disappear. We can get into this. The numbers are not there. Like, you can wait for the midterms, as Sandra mentions. I think there'll be a bit of a shift in the Senate, there'll be a bit of a shift in the House of Representatives, but they're not gonna get rid of this guy until they deal with abortion and, you know, same-sex marriage and all the other things that they're preoccupied with. They want their agenda implemented. He is gonna be a fact of our lives, unless the Lord takes him home, for the next while. So why don't we take advantage of it in a business sense? That would be my advice.
Hey, have we done a good job of that, or have we missed the boat, do you think? Should we have been more aggressive at the onset?
I think the federal government should have been more aggressive on it, yeah. I think that Trudeau is walking a tightrope, and I understand why he's doing that, but the danger is you can fall off. And he is in danger of doing that because there is a constituent. I guess you guys are hearing from Horvath?
Yes.
I have not. I'm a liberal. I don't know what she's going to say, but I have a hunch what she's going to say. She's going to kick the crap out of Donald Trump this afternoon because her party sees an opportunity. The Canadians do not like this guy. They do not like his style of business, and they are going to take partisan advantage of that if Trudeau and the Conservative Party let him.
And you know what? Some of that, like talking to the business people here that actually are involved in doing infrastructure projects with the municipal sector, provincial or federal, there are a couple of areas where this may be exactly the fire that we've needed to get moving much more quickly in Canada. Mm-hmm. There, assume that the $1 trillion program for infrastructure that Trump intends to implement actually happens. If he brings private money in because they have none, they're actually much further behind on the use of the private sector for infrastructure than Canadians are. So if they actually get going with that, we'll have to worry of a limited amount of trained staff to actually build stuff, a limited amount of companies who are going to want to build, right? So it gives us a little bit of impetus to say, okay, you know what? If he actually does that, we better get moving right now so we can lock in our programs and get the building done first. So for us, you know, like a takeaway is, how do we move our stuff forward faster? And we should be looking at that at every level of government.
So we're talking about this economic shift in reaction. He's proposed a number of different reforms to things like the corporate tax rate. How do you see that playing out on the competitiveness or the competitiveness
gap between the two countries? Changing the scope and supply mix of energy, we are in serious danger. And there's no point, I mean, we can pretend there's Chatham House rules here, but we all have to talk honestly about this, that if we don't get this stuff in check, we are going to be right out of competitiveness and in that position. If they come close to our corporate tax rate, which they've got a ways to go, by the way, because we're significantly less, if their energy mix goes to cheap coal, Ontario will never be able to compete. So can we do next best, right? I appreciate everything we've done historically on climate change, and we've been leading the charge, but if you look at the impact that Canada can make compared to the world of the massive economies who are doing nothing, I would submit that we're more worthwhile to spend all of that energy at these international fora and bodies to make them heal, because we are not making a world difference with what we're doing in Canada, and at the same time, we're making ourselves completely uncompetitive, more so now than even 6 months ago.
Okay. Chris, how do you see this playing out?
Well, I guess maybe the reason that I'm so sanguine about Trump is that I want to keep the relationship going. And I worry, so I give Justin Trudeau some credit. I think he's been very cautious, but because he doesn't want to be the next Mexico. He doesn't want to be the next Angela Merkel or whatever.
Now,
he's managed to be less craven than Theresa May. He didn't come and try to be too suck-uppy, but he's tried to walk that line. And I agree, it's a very difficult line for him. There's room for premiers and others to work within that, you know, sort of under the umbrella of good official relations to sort of negotiate. But I think he's got a very tough job. And I'm one who thinks on the midterms, Democrats are defending more seats in Trump states, both for the Senate and the House, than in the last election. And if Trump hasn't lost yet, he isn't looking like a loser, I think the Republicans will do very well.
You probably know these numbers by heart, but when Trump won, many people stayed home.
Yes.
Voters, many, many stayed home. So the reason that I think that these in 2-year elections are going to be very different is that they will either have been so horrified that they stayed home and let this happen, that in 2 years, their next kick at the can, we are going to see tremendous change because they hate what's happened, or everybody who stayed home said, oh my God, I'm liking what this guy is doing, and in droves, they will maintain the Republican order.
But
so
in midterm elections, we usually
happen,
don't have
right?
a lot of voters show up, not like presidential elections.
But I think this time will be different.
And as I mentioned in my talk, if the millennials don't engage politically in a more effective way, then the baby boomers are going to give up, and we are going to be stuck. So I wouldn't rely on 2-year change. I'm with Warren. I think at least you've got to wait till 2020 before you see a change. And so your strategy has to be how to look for areas of competitive advantage. And
This is where I go back to Congress. If the president's able to lower the corporate tax rate to 15% or get close to it, if he's able to make some of these changes, one of the challenges of the Obama years, and I mean this gently, I'm not being critical, but we created a lot of policy-driven uncertainty that left business sitting on cash, like Apple, sitting in huge piles of cash rather than investing. Why? Well, we knew what our debt to GDP ratio was. We thought taxes were going to go up. We just didn't know on who. We knew what our health care costs were. They were going sky high. We didn't know whether Obamacare was going to last or be repealed. And it was uncertain every year because we passed it in a partisan way. We weren't sure what was going to happen with labor rates because we had an immigration policy that was lenient on immigration. And we had different states and different municipalities doing minimum wage laws. So I think we created a lot of policy-driven uncertainty. Trump brings a different kind of uncertainty, but if he can settle some key things and get investors going, it'll be really tough on Canada because Canada's always been sort of that country on the margin. Now here, let me say something nice about Canada. You just
well,
got the CETA.
Nice so far.
Oh, I know. But you just got the CETA passed or ratified by the European Union Parliament. And that's really important because that means that first, you're the natural way for the Europeans to come into North American markets. And you've got the best deal going. Plus, Britain will ratify before Brexit, which means that Britain's way into the North American economy and their access to Europe will be stabilized by the existence of a CETA.
Let me be realistic.
No, I'm just saying,
realistically
speaking, you're in a good position.
The companies that we chase, companies that fit our sectors here in Ontario, I'll speak for Ontario at least with more history for me. The biggest argument is you're coming here for the market. You're not coming here for Ontario's market. You're not even coming here for Canada's market. You're coming here for the American market. And until we can resolve with some certainty what that looks like for a Canadian-operated Belgian company, European company at all, if we can't say with ease you're getting into the American market, we've just eliminated 50% of the argument to come to Canada. That is a big worry for me.
Yes.
How do we combat that? Lower corporate tax rates, better energy prices, a type of sector that we chase that isn't so determined that they have to have a product. Like, for example, the tech industry, which virtually can ship their product all over through the globe on the internet, for example. That's a group to chase. The ones that are going to do heavy R&D, pharmaceutical, tiny things that get shipped so you really can ship around the globe, but that the market is truly global, not just America. Yeah. The biggest industry in Ontario is manufacturing, and the largest, 95% of all of our product goes to the US. So half of the Ontario government's ministry work is pretty much being set aside until we figure this out. So realistically speaking, we need to get off our arse and figure this out and chase the sectors that despite this uncertainty, we have a very good standing. And that means, you know, capital coming in from the GCC, the Gulf states who are desperate for safe money havens, that's Canada. Those are the kinds of things that all of a sudden we should have a tremendously aggressive agenda.
Warren, do you want to jump in there?
Yeah, it's interesting listening to this perspective because a lot of these arguments, Hillary Clinton tried valiantly to make a lot of these arguments in the last presidential campaign. And full disclosure, my wife and I worked for the Clinton campaign in New Hampshire and Maine and in her Brooklyn headquarters. And it was out there. Like in June was Brexit, and Brexit was similarly a surprise. And the insularity of people's views, literally putting up walls, either in terms of economies or social issues and programs and policy. And it, you know, was it an outlier? Was it an aberration? Well, it clearly wasn't because, 5 months later, the same thing happened in the United States. The problem I've got as somebody who loves politics and loves polls and reading them is that the things that I want are not in sync with what a lot of people want, a lot of the public want. I know Canada, we're kind of outside of that right now, and I think it was partly Trudeau came along at a moment where people were kind of sick of the last government and they'd been there for a decade and that's good enough, that's long enough. But that sentiment that we saw in Brexit in June and with Trump in November, it is real. It is there and it is vibrant and strong still in public opinion. So whatever issues we pursue, whether it's bilateral agreements or you know, lobby strategies or what have you, that sentiment, which obviously Kelly Leach and Kevin O'Leary think it exists in Canada, it's out there, and it is real. And until we confront it and deal with it, guys like me are going to continue to lose.
So do we need... Initially, when I was crafting this question, I was thinking, like, do we need a strategy to contain the crazy? But I think a more genteel way of putting it would be, how do we reconcile this sort of value divide that seems very apparent right now between what we have prioritized here in Canada or in Ontario and what we see embedded in the executive and the congressional branch of the American government?
Can I take a first stab at that?
Definitely. Absolutely.
Just Trudeau, I mean, Sandra knows Trudeau. I think all of us have met him. Like, Trudeau, I think, actually, to his credit, is the right guy to deal with Trump, better than Harper would have been, because Trudeau kind of grew up around rich, idiosyncratic, weird people. So he knows how to... He knows how to handle them. And he obviously... No, but he's handled Trump pretty well so far, hasn't he? But the problem is, sooner or later, Trump is going to do something that will profoundly piss us off as a country. And we're counting on Justin Trudeau, who's the principal spokesperson for the country, to do what his father always talked about, which is, who speaks for Canada? And this is why I think he's in some peril, to answer your question.
Yeah.
He is the one to try and manage Trump. But how do you manage a guy who can't be managed? How do you do that for 4 years? Because I think we're going to be dealing with this son of a bitch for 4 years. So,
and you know what? And I agree. I think actually Trudeau did a fantastic. I was delighted to, for the most basic of things that I admit that I never watched Apprenticeship more than the commercial of it, right? It's just so stupid. This whole reality TV crap has bugged me for a long time. And he's made a career out of it. So he was like the Kardashians, kind of famous for being famous. That's what I think. But the fact that Trudeau could get out of that car, grab him by the arm, pound him on the side before Trump had a chance to do it first, I thought was fabulous. Because he's a kind of child that is, you know, it's like you have to deal with him like you do the guys at the bar. And Trudeau seemed to understand that instantly, and this was how he was reacting with him, and they get along just fine. Trudeau would be respected by Trump because Trudeau's famous.
Right.
And Trudeau is famous around the world. There are people infatuated with him, men and women, and Trump would respect that. So in my view, he's the perfect guy.
Yeah, the idea that he's the only celebrity to give him any
credibility. Yeah, it's like
credibility.
Celebrity to celebrity. I think we know that there's more to it for our guy than that, and he certainly is showing that with his policies. He also said very clearly, in a very nice way, I'm not coming to America to tell them how to run their business. We do different things. But there will come a time, as there came with Diefenbaker back in the day, when the U.S. did not want Canada to send wheat to China. And you know what we said? Screw you, we're sending wheat to China. And they were furious. So there will come a time when, you know, the rubber hits the road and we're going to do our own thing, whether that's going to be a China policy, which we are talking about openly here, and so we should, because you don't have to take a long boat to China anymore. We've got a huge opportunity with the economy now with China, and the Americans are not going to like this. So again, this could be the fire that we've needed under our arse to get going with the rest of the world, which we never take advantage of because America has always been so easy. So to that end, this is a huge opportunity for us. Whether we like him, don't like him, my view is that Trump respects people who are prepared to fight back. That's the kind of guy that every one of us had in grade school in our class. They all, you know, the bully appreciates a bully. That's all there is to it. And I think we need to stand up for the things that we have, which are plenty, and do our own thing, which may well end up being more engagement with the rest of the world than might have otherwise happened without this.
Yeah, I absolutely agree with that. I think Canada does need to diversify its markets. I would say that for sure. However, one of the things that people who've tangled with Trump have found is he's very good at throwing something shiny in one direction so you don't pay attention to what's happening.
True.
And the media, I think, have been suckers for it really since the campaign. Mm. And so it's easy to get caught up in the outrage of the day and so on. Meanwhile, things are happening quietly behind the scenes and sometimes in full view that are really important. We're not going to renegotiate NAFTA in a day. We're probably going to have a North American Leaders Summit like the one that we had in Ottawa probably in June of this year, and we'll start North American negotiations. And it could take 2 years or 3 years to come up with some sort of deal. Trump will still be happy. Things are going on. Similarly with Congress, we won't have, despite the tweets and executive orders, eventually you settle down, you have to do legislation, and that'll take time. So as citizens, we're all interested in the latest thing, but we also have to keep our cool. And when I remember back to the Canada's Free Trade Agreement negotiations, after negotiations, the one thing you always said about the Canadians, they were the best prepared people in the room. They always made sure they'd done their homework. They thought about what's the opportunity, what's the risk. You've got a great team representing you, not only in the government, but in the civil service, at the federal level, at the provincial level. You've got to give them room to start getting engaged. There's no reason you will lose this fight a priori. You could do very well. And you have to make sure that you focus on the main thing and not the distractions of the Trump tweet of the day.
So is there an opportunity, and sort of final question here while we transition to the end of the day, but is there an opportunity for Canada to be the Trump whisperer for the rest of the world, to play this sort of middle role between the rest of the world and the crazy we have next door? With all due respect, of course.
He's a monkey with a machine gun. How do you whisper to that?
Carefully. Sorry. And from a distance.
I think he took opportunity, you know, whether someone whispered to him, okay, this is Canada, this is our friend, and Trudeau's a very popular guy, even in America, which is true. He was like the prince that showed up in New York. I mean, the Trudeau phenomena is unbelievable, and my only regret is that I'm not younger, because I just missed out on his father's Trudeau mania. So I had the really interesting discovery that my mother is enamored of the son while I was enamored of the father, which is really weird. Okay, it's just yeah. Weird. Anyway, but I do think that the way he is approaching us and everything he said about us is that even he's recognized that the guys right next door, we need to keep them close. So he has not had any kind of derogatory, even a slight misstep with us. And I think that that's been planned and he's been well counseled. I just want to harken back to one point that Warren made that I thought was critical in this, and that's for Canadians to really understand, which we do not, just how difficult it is for some belts in the US that Canada does not experience. The safety net in Canada will never have people doing as poorly as they have in some states in the US. That leads to, I mean, look, a lot of people in this room go to Florida or wherever you go in the South for warmth, you know, and you talk to people, if you talk to the waitress in the local place, North Carolina, wherever, they make $2 an hour and you hope that they've got tips, because that's it. There's no minimum wage, we can't conceive of what they don't have, because we live in Canada and we just take it for granted what we have. So we're never gonna have that visceral hate on for government or who they purport to have caused them the grief that they live, like I've seen in the US. So if we don't understand that fundamental, we really won't believe that there could be so many people that actually believe in this guy, this Trump guy. But honestly, it was, you know, it is that phenomena that we just can't see it here, and we're just so lucky that we don't see it.
We are holding this discussion in a city that did elect Rob Ford, and there do seem to be some parallels. Is there a notion that somehow we're being smugged through this entire process?
You know, I have been a member of Rotary International for many, many years, and there's a saying in this club. I don't know if there are any Rotarians in the room. I don't want to embarrass us while I say this. Rotary is such a strong organization, it will never be ruined by one president. That's what they say. And there's a system in Rotary of you sort of get your training as you move up the chain, and then you become president. So you're only ever there for enough time, and there's such backup that you can't really screw it up. I believe that people think that about Canadian governments, mayors, etc. Their system is so pristine. There's such a check and balance. There's no, you can't even imagine the Prime Minister of our country calling out and berating the local media as Trump has done in the U.S. That simply would not happen here. A matter of fact, the public would go racing to protect the media if they were being attacked, as has happened in the U.S. So we just have a bigger sense of order. You know, that kind of staid, calm order of things is much more prevalent in Canada. And, you know, so yeah, Ford, it's like you can sort of throw it away because you've got 50 people on council, for God's sake, or is there 100 on City Council of Toronto? I don't know. There's too many, but I'm just saying it's big. There's lots of people. So one guy for this time, we're going to teach him a lesson. And that's how I saw it. And he was incredibly popular.
Chris, I will say, and I'm a big fan of Canadians always, but, you know, Dean Acheson, going back a ways, who had Canadian relatives, once said, you know, Canada in international affairs acts like the stern daughter of the voice of God. And, you know, the American election, if it was about anything, it was about really feeling the establishment had been talking down to the American people for a long time and not listening to them. I knew you had some of that with Rob Ford's election here. I think Canada doesn't mean to be smug or holier than thou or better and superior, but can come off that way if it's not careful. And that can happen with any Canadian, can happen. So you just be conscious of and empathetic, because I think Canadians are empathetic, that the U.S. is going to be going through a rough time. Not everybody is on the Trump train, for sure, and we all want to get through it in one piece. And so your compassion, your friendship, will be much appreciated. And, you know, try to avoid falling into that sense that you are superior, even if your leader has better hair than ours.
Beauty's in the eye of the beholder.
True, but at least I know how that feels, to go around the world
you
and have someone
excellent
say...
Hair. And your hair is beautiful.
I thought you were talking to me.
all right. Stop me dead in my tracks with that one. Jesus. Anyway.
Well, Chris has summed up how my wife talks about me, slightly off-putting at times, and I need to mind how I present myself to others. On that note, I can't think of a more appropriate way to wrap up this conversation. So, again, please join me. I'm going to extend gratitude to Warren Kinsella, Sandra Pupatello, and Chris Sands for taking time out. I think this has been, if not a robust and informative discussion, certainly an entertaining one. So thank you.
Warren, I thought you were great. I'd do that again. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I would do that again. You were great.
Yeah, no, so did I.
That was very good. Thank you.
He needed a line to get out of here. Very nice to meet you.
Very nice to meet you. Thanks, Scott. I'm going to take my little keys and go.
I believe our next speaker.
This way.
Hi. Hi, I'm Warren.
How are you doing?
How do you do? Please meet you. Never met you.
Jeez. Yeah, I have. How are you?
Hi, how do you do, Allison?
Good. Oh, I'm hanging in.
We run in similar Twitter circles, at least.
Good afternoon, everybody. A little change in venue. Max is not with us, so we're Andrea Horwath, the leader of the opposition, or the Ontario New Democrats. From her early career in community development today, she always believes that the government should be about giving people the opportunity to build a good life, no matter where they live in Ontario, or when province became home. Born and raised in Hamilton, Andrea was elected to Hamilton City Council in 1997, then as MPP for Halton Centre in 2004. Andrea will say a few words, and then she'll be joined by Allison Smith. Thank you, sir. Please welcome Andrea Horwath.
Thank you, Rick. Good afternoon, everyone. Bonjour à toutes et à tous. I want to thank Councillor Champagne for the kind introduction, and I want to thank all the members of the Board of Directors for the invitation to join you this afternoon. It's great to be back at the Ontario Good Roads Association. It's great to see so many friends and familiar faces. Many of our New Democrat MPPs are with me here today and have been spending some time with folks, having various meetings. I know I just saw Gilles Bisson walk in the room. John Vantoff is here. Mike Mantha, Percy Hatfield, having meetings all day with you folks that have been very, very productive. And it has been an extremely exciting day for New Democrats today. We've been having excellent discussions, of course, with delegations from around the province, and this morning at Queen's Park, I made a major announcement that I want to share with all of you here today. You are the local leaders in our communities, and New Democrats are determined to work with you to find real solutions to the challenges that Ontario faces. I sat on City Council in Hamilton for years. I stood in your shoes. I know how important your job is and how tough it can be. I learned how incredibly frustrating it is to see a provincial government making decisions that don't help our communities. That is the kind of thing, actually, that drove me as an individual to work for change at the provincial level. I share a lot of your frustration with the current government, not the least of which is the lack of transparency around infrastructure funding and how many barriers the government has put in place with the Ontario Community Infrastructure Fund. On so many issues, it comes down to this. Leadership matters. I gotta say, I couldn't agree more with OGRA's theme this year. I love that theme. Leadership matters. We need leadership in this province that actually gets what's happening in Ontario today. Leadership that understands what's being done to ordinary people, businesses, and our communities. And leadership that works with you to make real changes to help all of the people that we serve. We live in a great province, but today, Ontario is hitting a tipping point. Costs keep going up, pressures are growing, and rather than helping, the current government is making life harder for a lot of folks and a lot of our communities. Our children need great schools, great local schools, but the Premier is closing schools in every corner of Ontario. And moms and dads are being forced to fight tooth and nail to save their children's schools. Families shouldn't have to fight against their own government in order to keep their schools open. Nobody voted for that. Personne n'a voté pour ça. And it's the same with healthcare. Families need access to local hospitals, and seniors need home care and long-term care without waiting for months to get it. But this Liberal government has forced hospitals to cut services, and more than 1,500 nursing positions in the past 2 years have been cut. Patients are the ones who are paying the price. Emergency room wait times are now longer than they've been in nearly a decade. People need to know that they will have access to great public services in all of our communities. And every family and every business needs to be able to afford the basics. Electricity isn't a luxury, so it shouldn't be priced like one. But the current government is driving up the cost of electricity, making it harder for people to pay the bills and harder for businesses to invest in Ontario and create new jobs. The peak price for hydro has increased by 50% since this premier came to office just 4 years ago. I've talked to families and business owners all across the province, in every corner of Ontario, in all of the towns that you come from. And it's the same story, and you've heard it yourselves too many times. What do people say? We're literally afraid to open our hydro bills. That's what people tell me. They are afraid to open their hydro bills. I've talked to so many people and they look me in the eye and they say to me, we are at the breaking point. We can't take it anymore. I think of a woman that I met in Cambridge. Her name is Adele. And I met her just before Christmas. She's a single mom and she has 3 kids. And the feeling she described to me, the feeling of having her throat, her heart literally in her throat every time she has to open that hydro bill, that shouldn't be happening in Ontario. That's a heartbreaking scenario, and it shouldn't be happening in Ontario, and it's happening everywhere in Ontario. I think of seniors like Sharon. I met Sharon in Sault Ste. Marie. Sharon's a retired nurse. She's about 80 years old. She spent her life as a nurse caring for other people. Her husband passed on a couple of years ago, and she's all alone, struggling with her hydro bills. And those hydro bills are hitting close to $300 a month. So whether you're a middle-class family or a fixed-income senior or a business owner paying for outrageous hydro bills, paying for someone else's profits off our electricity system is just not possible. And I wish the Premier got that. I wish that she understood that. It's just not possible, and it's just not right. We need lower hydro bills. Il nous faut agir sans tarder. Il nous faut réduire les tarifs d'électricité. Il nous faut du changement. We need to take on the real problems and cost drivers in our electricity system. Premier Wynne has proven that she will not do that job in a real and sustainable way. I don't at all accept the Premier's latest position. With an election on the horizon, that we should just take a short-term Band-Aid approach and put that Band-Aid on hydro by taking money away from our schools, taking it away from our hospitals, taking it away from our transportation systems. I don't accept the Premier's idea that the people of Ontario should subsidize expensive private and foreign power companies, because that's what we're doing, and that's why we're in the mess that we're in. But the Premier is offering no real solutions to our electricity system, and frankly, I don't believe the Conservatives are either. With all due respect to Mr. Brown, and I know he'll be speaking to you tomorrow morning, after 17 years as a Conservative politician, the vast majority of Ontarians still have no idea where he stands or what he's proposing to do. But people know that Conservative cuts and privatization are not the answer for what's ailing Ontario. Privatization is a huge part of what's got us into this hydro mess in the first place. And it's not what Ontario needs. It's time to stand up for Ontario. And the NDP has an ambitious and, I believe, achievable plan to get control over our hydro rates. And today I want to share with you our plan to lower hydro bills by up to 20%, and for some people, 30% or more. It's time for the people of Ontario to pay less and own more of our hydro. We will restore fairness by ensuring that rural and seasonal consumers pay the same delivery costs as urban customers. We've got to make it fair. We'll put what's best for people first by capping private profits, ending mandatory time of use, and bringing real oversight to electricity prices. We'll give the Ontario Energy Board a new mandate to stand up for the public and push for lower bills. People will see the results. We'll lower bills for much of rural and northern Ontario by 30% or more. And what a change that'll be. What a needed change that'll be. We'll end the ridiculous practice of paying for electricity that we don't need here in the province and cancel or renegotiate bad contracts. And I'm talking about those private contracts that Liberals and Conservatives have signed that make insiders wealthy but leave Ontarians paying for electricity that we cannot use. Affordable, reliable, clean power will be the backbone of the electricity system under an NDP government. And most importantly, we will do what neither the Liberals or the Conservatives are willing to do. We will stop the failed privatization of Ontario's electricity system and build a public power system that serves the public interest. When you pay your hydro bill, you should be paying for electricity, not for someone else's profits. Public hydro is absolutely essential to building a strong economy and an affordable future for all our communities. So, New Democrats will listen to more than 200 municipalities who've shown remarkable courage by passing resolutions against the sell-off of Hydro One. You are great, great leaders. You're essential partners. And it's about time we had a government that respects you and listens to what you have to say. New Democrats will stop the disastrous sell-off of Hydro One, just as municipalities have been demanding, and we will bring Hydro One back into public hands. I'm committing today that the first bill I'll introduce as Premier will be to start returning Hydro One to public ownership and control. Hydro should belong to the people of Ontario. End of story. It should work in the interest of all Ontarians, and the people of Ontario should be in control of the cost of our electricity. This is our plan to lower hydro bills by as much as 30%, and to do it in a way that is long-term and sustainable. And I'm excited to work with you to make it happen. We live in a province that can do great things. We have incredible potential. We just need leadership at the provincial level that works as hard as you do for the people of Ontario. We need a provincial partner that every community can trust to do what's right and build a great future for people today and for the next generation. In the years to come, when I talk to families, seniors, and businesses across this province, I don't want to hear worry and frustration in their voices. I want to put hope and optimism back into people's lives. That's the leadership, that's the partnership, and that's the change that New Democrats are determined to deliver. So thank you very much for listening to my formal remarks. Merci beaucoup. And I believe that now I'm going to be joined by Allison Smith for a bit of an informal chat. Thanks.
Thanks, Rick.
Allison Smith from the Queen's Park today. I'm sure we're going to have a very interesting discussions going on, so thank you.
Thanks, Rick.
Thank you.
I'm just going to,
yeah, sure. All right, hello everyone. You may know me from interviewing the Premier an hour and a half ago. All right, so Andrea, judging by the polls, the 2018 election looks like it could very well be a close race, a close three-way race. Can you tell the audience how your vision for Ontario is different than the current Premier's?
Sure. I mean, one of the things that I think I outlined in a kind of partial way in my speech is this sense of frustration and worry that people have. Ontario, as I said, can be a great province, but folks are hitting a wall these days, and they're very, very concerned that even the basics aren't something that they can count on anymore. I mean, we have a hospital system that's been squeezed so tight that, as I said in the speech, waiting times in emergencies are up significantly. Nobody voted for that. That's not what people expect. They expect an electricity system that they can, you know, rely on and that they can actually afford their bills. A hospital system and a healthcare system that's there for them when they need it. And as I mentioned in the speech as well, schools that serve your community. I mean, you don't want to have kids on school buses for, 2.5-3 hours a day, because that's not a good way to ensure that kids can get not only the richness of their day in class, but also attending after school activities. We also have a situation in Ontario where work has eroded significantly, the quality of work. People are working 2 and 3 jobs just to get by. People don't have the kind of benefits that they need to be able to, for example, take care of their teeth. I mean, literally, somebody could have an accident and end up having to max out their credit cards just to pay for their teeth. So there are a number of things that we want to see changed here in the province of Ontario, and the basic reality is it has to be about people. It has to be about people and their communities and the services that they expect from their government.
Speaking of labor and benefits, are you looking forward to the province's workplace labor review that's coming out this week?
Well, I mean, it's a long time coming. I mean, I'm pretty sure it was supposed to be due almost a year ago now. So it's something that people have been waiting for. But look, I mean, we have seen the explosion of what we call precarious work in this province for the last decade. I mean, it's not a coincidence that explosion of precarious work has occurred at the same time as we've seen a massive increase in the number of temp agencies here in Ontario. And yet this very government, the Liberal government, twice, has brought legislation pretending that they were going to deal with the scourge of temp agencies in Ontario, and they haven't. To this day, they have not been successful. So, am I looking forward to it? Only insofar as it's been a long time coming. But I have to say, I don't put very much faith in this government. They take half measures. They do things that are more about the window dressing and are more about making sure that their political backsides are being covered than they do to make real change that has a positive impact in people's lives. Is that a bit cynical?
So if you were elected premier in 2018, in 5 years, how would the province's relationship with municipalities be different than it is now?
Oh, that's a really good question. And I mean, there's some things I've already talked about. So for example, we've talked about being a real partner with municipalities when it comes to transportation funding, when it comes to being a partner with social housing, when it comes to being there on making sure that we have affordable childcare for families. I've made commitments around our hospitals and making sure that they're being funded not only for population growth and for, you know, aging demographic and those kinds of things, but we also recognize that there needs to be particular attention, and for inflation, right? So inflationary costs also have to be funded for. There needs to be a particular attention to the reality of small hospitals in small communities and in northern communities. So our healthcare system would have a lot of attention. We're quite unhappy with the home care system here in Ontario. There would be big changes there. We've made commitments around the minimum wage, so we would see people actually being able to earn enough money to put a roof over their head if they work full-time. We would be doing some real reform around temp agencies. So, for example, we've made the commitment that nowhere in Ontario should someone be working right beside someone else and making, you know, 20 or 30% less than that other person is making. It's not just, and it's not right. And so, I mean, that's just a sprinkling of the things that we would be doing differently. And again, it's all about making sure that people feel like they can build a good life here. And I mean, that's what I hear from a lot of folks. They feel like they can't build a good life here anymore. And they're not only worried about themselves and their families, but they're worried about the next generation too. Very worried about the next generation. And we should never be in that situation in a great province like Ontario, because we do have a great deal of potential. We just have to make sure that government focuses on what it is that makes life better for people.
So this morning you announced changes to how you would handle the privatization of Hydro One if you were elected premier, and we'll get to that in a moment. But one of the things you said was that the very first thing you would do would be to introduce this legislation repurchasing the privatized shares. Mm-hmm. And just to throw back to your last answer regarding the minimum wage, how quickly would you move forward with an increase to the minimum wage you were, I think, have promised $15?
Yes,
we made the promise. Would that be like an immediate jump?
We made the promise for $15 minimum wage because we think it's a long time coming, frankly. And a part of what we have now in Ontario is this increase that comes with changes to the CPI. And that's fine, except that the amount that you're tying it to was a minimum wage that already was keeping people living in poverty. So on the current formula that this government has in place, we would hit a minimum wage of $15 an hour sometime around 2030, with kind of averaged increases in the CPI based on what we've seen. That's not acceptable, 2030. Now, I know, as a person who has worked very closely with the business community, both when I was a city councillor in the downtown of Hamilton, but also, you know, meeting with Chamber of Commerce and Board of Trade and folks like that, not only here in Toronto, but across all the communities. And one of the things that's clear is that any adjustments like that, they need notice of. You can't just do it overnight because that'll cause huge destabilization. There has to be ways of you know, providing some lead time, if you will. But certainly that is a commitment that we've made, and we will be implementing that. And then we've also looked at, and we did this in our last platform as well, are there ways to mitigate impacts, particularly on small business? Because we know that small business, frankly, is a large employer. I mean, a lot of the new jobs that we see coming to Ontario or are being created in Ontario are coming from small business. And so we don't have our full platform put together yet, and you'll be hearing more details of announcements, but certainly finding ways to mitigate impacts on mom and pops and on small businesses is something that we're quite committed to as well.
Okay. And you know, stretching from that, and we are talking about people living off minimum wage that maybe, or just wages in general, that aren't enough to, you know, heat or eat. Income inequality has become an issue internationally. Mm-hmm. And lots of people are feeling left behind, and it's leading to, you know, populist governments being elected. How would you, as a social democrat, address this growing issue? What are some solutions?
Well, I mean, this is exactly why we're talking about things like the temp agencies, and why we're talking about things like the minimum wage, and why we're talking about things like the potential for, you know, people having opportunities to have benefits at work. I mean, these are some of the very costly things that people can't afford, and so they end up being very marginalized, and that's not acceptable. But on the same token, while we're talking about how do we, you know, create a better and more stable and more secure life for some of the lowest income folks, or some of the folks who are at the lower end of the income scale, we also have to look at the other end of the income scale. I mean, let's face it. We just watched as some of the public servants in Ontario, or the staff of colleges particularly, talked about giving themselves raises of 100% in 1 year. I mean, it's not only a matter of making sure that we're dealing with with the lower income folks and the wage issue and all of that, but we have to start capping those CEO salaries. And we've been saying this for years, and the Liberals have ignored us for years. But if we're not even doing that in the public sector, then how can we expect the private sector to be considerate of making sure that, you know, wages are decent across their organizations, and that the CEOs aren't walking away with 300 times what the average worker makes? We know that in some jurisdictions, in some countries, there have been, you know, governments that have made laws about the private sector when it comes to that kind of wage disparity. What we need to do is, at the very least, take seriously our obligation to do that in the public sector. We've actually put forward private members' bills that have said no public sector worker, no manager, no CEO in a public sector organization should be making more than twice what the premier makes. And yet we have the government here in Ontario that continues to allow those salaries at the top to increase significantly, and that's not acceptable.
So we recently saw Premier Wynne crush the City of Toronto's hopes for generating revenue through tolling highways. And I know that you were against the Toronto tolls from day one, but a lot of municipalities, especially small ones, are looking for other ways to boost revenue, if not through tolling, but through, you know, being able to take control of that on their own. If you were leading the province after 2018, what changes would you make to allow municipalities to generate new revenue?
Well, I mean, I think there's two sides to that coin. One is how would we be a better partner with municipalities to help them fund some of the essentials that need to be funded and have been ignored? And then if there are still gaps, then what do we do to provide, you know, the room for them to make other kinds of you know, revenue streams available, and both of those things are on the table. But I mean, the first part is we've already made some commitments, as I've mentioned. I mean, in having that discussion around tolls, I mean, one of the problems that the New Democrats have with tolls and user fees is that they're regressive taxes. They are not progressive taxes, and everybody in this room that's had to increase the cost of arena rental time at your arenas, or that have had to increase the user fees at your community centers, you know very well that it's the lower income families that then become even less likely to participate and take advantage of those public services, and that's why we do not support that kind of flat tax, if you will, that kind of tax, because it's not progressive. What we believe needs to happen is that the province needs to be there for municipalities to help them with some of their major struggles, and that will open up room in their municipal budgets, their operating budgets, to be able to utilize the municipal property taxes for other purposes. So we made the commitment around transit funding that we would upload 50% of the transit funding that municipalities are using for operating. And so we know that not all municipalities have transit systems, but for those that do, we will take on 50% of the operating costs of those transit systems. I mean, this government didn't replace that cut that was made by the Harris government all those years ago, and it's just become worse and worse and worse every year. But they also got rid of the bus replacement program
another important program that helped municipalities replace some of the transit infrastructure in their communities, which was a big mistake. And again, something that has caused municipalities to then have to dip into their own capital budgets to cover off the cost of new buses, which are, well, geez, well, the last time I was looking at bus costs, it was like close to $600,000 for a single bus. It's probably even more now. You guys would know more than I about exactly the cost of a bus. But it's a significant hit on a municipal budget. So those are some of the things. On affordable housing, I mean, hopefully there's going to be an announcement with the federal government coming in their budget. We've heard many times promises around, you know, national housing strategy. Geez, I can remember when Paul Martin was promising a national housing strategy, you know, years and years ago. Apparently there's one coming in this coming budget. I hope there is, because municipalities need that kind of partnership when it comes to affordable housing. And I mean, we have some municipalities that are actually losing affordable housing stock because they can't keep the units up to snuff in terms of the maintenance and repairs. When that housing was downloaded by the Harris government, it came with not enough maintenance reserves and no replacement reserves. So how's a municipality going to find the money to maintain and replace that important investment? It's not going to happen. So hopefully we'll see some of that announcement. If not, I mean, certainly that's something that I'm absolutely committed to, should we form government in 2018, is being that partner when it comes to some of these big issues. Another one is childcare, and again, I mentioned it in passing a little while ago, but we have a real problem with childcare in Ontario. Families can't afford childcare. In some cases, I mean, here in this city, I think it's something like $1,600 a month for a family to have one child in childcare. I mean, in other communities, it's a little bit less, but I think overall, I don't think there's a single community where it's less than around $1,000 to have one child in childcare. Who could afford that? You know, so childcare is another place where we would be partnering again with municipalities. And here's the other thing I want to say. I mean, one of the things that's frustrating is the games that get played around downloading, uploading. I mean, it's just ridiculous. When I was talking to a particular municipal leader, he was talking about new mandates for public health new requirements for testing and these kinds of things, which is great, except that the new mandates come without any funding. And so I think there needs to be an acknowledgement that as we ask municipalities to do more on certain files, that they should come with some supports as well. And the idea that we play shell games with, well, we'll give you a little bit here, but we'll take it away over there. At the end of the day, if it doesn't make any difference in terms of what you have to provide services to your residents in your municipality, then really there's been no gain. And I think those kinds of silly games have been, you know, going on for far too long here in Ontario. And that's why I say we need to have a real, honest, upfront partnership between the province and municipalities.
So there are the games that are played with uploading and downloading of services, but then there's also ones that are played with, you know, governments moving, new governments coming in, and whether or not they're going to fund or drop or change things that the previous government has funded. The premier's pledged $160 billion for transit infrastructure over the next 12 years. Given the state of the province's debt, is that something that you would carry forward if you were elected and fulfill that promise?
You know, there's no doubt that there has been a huge lack of attention to infrastructure over the last number of years. I mean, this is the conference that talks mm-hmm. about those things in just one sector, which is transportation, right? Ontario Good Roads. But look, there's no doubt that we're committed to doing that, to investing in the infrastructure needs of Ontario. And you know, it's interesting, and I find it very frustrating that the government claims, or that the premier claims, that the only way you can fund infrastructure in Ontario is by selling off Hydro One. I mean, everybody knows that that's just balderdash. In fact, the Financial Accountability Officer pegged it, and we saw it just last week, where the government has taken credit now for, you know, being in better shape than it said it was going to be when it comes to the deficit reduction. And yet, what did they use to make that deficit balance? They used the money from Hydro One sell-off and the Ontario Teachers' Pension Fund. I mean, give me a break. If you want to talk about shell games and you want to talk about not being upfront about where the money's coming from. So the idea. So I raise that because today's announcement that we made was that we are going to buy back Hydro One. And we're going to bring Hydro One back into public hands. And all the premier can say is, well, that means there's not going to be enough money for infrastructure investment. $4 billion. $4 billion is what they expected to get. Now, $4 billion doesn't really buy much of a $160 billion infrastructure plan over a 12-year period. And so, again, I think it's silly for anybody to think that this plan that we have on Hydro One is going to negatively impact the investment on infrastructure. And if there's one last thing I want to say, it's that, you know, the infrastructure discussion tends to circle around, around the big public transit projects here in Toronto, in the GTHA, in the Kitchener-Waterloo corridor, and that's fine. But the reality is there are huge infrastructure challenges across the province. I mean, we have communities in parts of Northern Ontario that literally, if an accident happens, people are isolated for days on end. And if an accident happens that shuts down a highway in between communities that are part Highway 17, forget about it. Like, people are stuck for hours and hours and hours. Businesses are stuck. You know, goods can't be transported. So we know that there are problems that need to be addressed around Ontario. And in a very real way, it's even that much more challenging because the expectation is that some communities are able to, you know, deal with projects where a single bridge replacement, for example, would take up literally all of their 10-year capital plan. Like, all of their 10-year capital budget would be taken up by one bridge replacement. That's where the province needs to be a partner, making sure that no matter where you are in Ontario, you have the kind of infrastructure that keeps your community safe and functional and able to, and able to thrive.
So very quickly, just to wrap up, you put forward a lot of really good plans that could come into effect if you do become premier. How are you going to use, the next 18 months to try to get that message to Ontario and try to, get yourself there?
We're going to work like hell. That's what we're going to do. We're going to work hard. We're going to bring forward thoughtful plans and ideas. And I'm going to continue to spend a lot of time, and my MPPs are as well, listening to what people have to say and bringing plans forward that actually address the concerns and problems that people have. Because as I said before, this is a great province and it has great potential, but really people do feel like we're hitting a wall, that we have to see some real bold change if we're going to turn things around. And we can't go back to the old tired solutions of the past, the ones that have been raised over and over by the Conservatives, for example. More cutting, more privatization, that's not going to get us where we need to go. Thank you.
Thanks, Andrea.
Thanks, Allison.
Thanks, everyone.
It was a lot of fun.
Thank you very much, Allison and Andrea, for your professionalism and your questions and your answers, and we thank you very much.
Sir.
Thank you. Thank you.
Enjoy the rest of the conference.
Thank you. Okay, this concludes our program for today, and I'm pleased to announce that the Liberal Party of Ontario and the Progressive Conservative are hosting a reception this evening. The Liberal Party reception will be held in the Territories Room starting at 6:30. The PC Party will be commenced at 6:30 in the Confederation Room number 5. All delegates are all invited to attend. Enjoy your evening and see you back here first thing in the morning. Thank you very much.
I've been thinking about